Hi Vinu. Hi Varad.
Hello.
Hi. Venu, we are live. I mean, anything which we speak here will come in YouTube also.
Okay. What is that?
Yes, Venu.
Hello.
Yeah, you can hear it. I know we are live. I mean, anything which we speak here will come in YouTube also. We can hear you. There is no issue on that.
What is that?
Yes, we know.
No?
Yeah, you can hear it. I know we are live. Anything which we speak here will come in YouTube also. We can hear you. There is no issue on that.
What is that?
Yes, we know.
No?
Yeah, you can hear it. I know we are live. Hi, Nishan. We're good to start the session in a few minutes. It's 9:55 right now, the 10 a.m. or like, let's say maybe 5 minutes of here and there, small changes. In the meantime, I think we can get to know each other. You know, we could just get to know about where you're from, what interests you to take part in this the training program. That's the way we can get to know about you. Just tell us, like, you know, where you're from, what background of engineering are you, and what interests you to take part in this course. And it would be very fun in learning the course too. So we're just waiting for you. We have 10, and we would be waiting for some more people to join. So we have, I think, close around a single engaged and interactive. To do so, you would require a notepad to do the calculations and to take a note of various different things. So I request you to also keep your notepads ready. And I would say even the calculator for you, rather than very exciting for you. So as far as you also involved along the course. Okay, so we have Siddesh from Mumbai. Maharashtra, second year mechanical engineering, currently working on FSA electric project. That's quite interesting, Siddesh. That's good. That's good. We have more people joining in a minute or two. So I think this is Goku, completed BE in metallurgy, looking to retrofit EV company for three wheelers. Wow, that's quite interesting, Goku. There's a good thing as such. I feel like writing down the line, things would be great. I think even the kit also sort of not standardized, I believe. I think that's a good thing to start from now. And by the meantime, I think when the industry is kind of hitting out, but very early to market. Hi, Venu, you're there? Hello? Hello? Bharat? Sorry about it. I just lost my connectivity of internet. So back now. Bharat, you're there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So I think I have a little feeble network. If in case my network get lost. So Venu, you're there. So please do take over the session. Yeah.
Shall I record the session, Suraj?
Yeah, please go ahead and record the session, Bharat. So I'm sorry about a small technical glitch. So we lost the contact. So we're back now. I believe you can hear me too. So it's quite good. I think it's good to know everybody. So Asim, Vicky, Akash, Apoorv, Shiv Kumar. Thanks a lot, everybody, by the way, to joining in. So the session is just about to begin. I think we'll start out with the session. Thanks a lot for joining in. So we'll start over the session. So I would just run you through a quick overview here. What is a course plan, the course learning plan. So here is a course learning plan, which we have planned for the today's session. So it would be starting on the module one, so a bit about introduction. And then the module two would involve about all the rolling resistance forces, aerodynamic forces, gradient forces, and like calculation of acceleration forces. I would say theoretical fundamentals of all of them. And then we will take an example and solve the problems for in selecting a specific transmission with Ather 450. Then we would move ahead for a motor torque, motor RPM, and the motor power and motor current and things like that. So, and then the other side, we have battery current, the battery pack power, number of cells, and number of cells in series and parallel. So this would be the overall, you know, the flow of the whole course. So only the module two until point number four, we would have a theory session, but right after that, everything is completely practical. So that, you know, you would definitely have more fun learning the whole course intuitively with hand calculation. So as per recommended, so please do have a notepad so that you know you would be able to write down things when you want to practice. Yeah. So that's a bit about the course flow, and I would take a minute here, privileged to introduce Decibels. Decibels has four business verticals, which is we started in 2017. So one of the business vertical for us would be the education sector, which we have been involved quite some time from now, doing a lot of corporate trainings for various different clients across India and different countries too. So as a part of the continuation, so we opened up the online learning platform 3 months ago for all the learners out there. So through that, we engage and deliver a lot of training programs, and we've been training more than 5,000 students by now in the last 3 months. So it's a learning platform, which is career oriented with affordable course structures and a platform for engineers to learn and to enter into a sector of electric vehicle. Then the other side, we also provide consulting services. So consulting services, which includes the various simulation activities and partner development for various startups in India and also other part of the world too. So in Europe and some parts of US. And apart from it, we also set up research and development labs at universities and also at the industries. So because we are connected to an education sector and also industry sector, so there are a lot of clients who ask for engineers, the trained engineers, because as you also know, there is no such a very good institute which could provide you a complete end-to-end learning in the EVs, and even though there may be few, the number of people are very less graduating out from there. So Decibels has all of that with the industry connects. So we provide employment services for various graduates out of our classes, out of the training programs. a bit about Decibels community, which you are a part of community, and that's why you're attending the courses too. So it's a privilege. That the dream was to build a largest community of engineers in the EV sector, that, you know, the EV sector would never have a deficiency of good engineers, because as such, we see today that, you know, the huge number of components and our technology, everything is actually brought from another country to utilize to build an EV. So idea is, when I was there in US and also another part of the places, when I interact with a lot of my colleagues, and there have been extensive research from very long time about EVs in various universities there. And there's been a tremendous amount of tech development, investment which has been happening in other countries for the EV development. So idea with EV community is, you know, why don't we in India ourselves can do this and ourselves can develop technology majorly and, you know, bring up products, innovative products, and, you know, solve the problems locally in the country, because India is a very unique place and the problems here are very unique and that requires to be addressed in a very unique way. So we just can't possibly buy components from China the same way and, you know, assemble them and possibly sell them. Because there's various reasons behind it why we can't do it. Maybe the temperatures are different here, the driving conditions are different here, the road conditions are different here. It requires a very unique the product design and unique, like, you know, packaging, pricing, everything. So the moment we don't have good engineers, obviously the industry lacks, and the industry lacks, then the growth also lacks in the sector, and the adoption of EV always become delayed. So when we thought about addressing it, then we thought, okay, why don't we build a community of people? So the dream was to build a community of 25,000 people. So we already have reached close to 5,000. Accurately, like 5,340 people we have reached till today in just last couple of days. So the dream is to build 25,000 people community by September. So there will be a lot of community events which we're going to be organizing for you. So it will be all free. There is nothing charged as such as the financials. Even the certifications also are provided free. And even such certifications even directly can be shared in LinkedIn for all your professional growths and things like that. So with all that idea, so we want to bring right people, because, you know, we also know there's enough engineers out there who are graduates or like, I would like say that another lot of graduates, but the skilled engineers are required. That's why there is all the certifications as to, you need to undergo certain quizzes and, you know, tests and projects, and then all the certificates is issued. That's the way the LMS is also designed in the back end from our side. So with all of that activities, it is to engage people more into EV sector, engage people more in learnings inside the EV. And by that way, your career also grows in a better manner. And we have more engineers in India to work on EV technology and to create more startups, to do more research in the areas of EV. That's the dream for us, to start the EV community. And this EV community is all possible because of amazing people we have across the country. We have 40 community leads who are there across the country at various different places in India. And we have been getting requests from other countries as well that people want to join the community as a leads. So, but we have unique people of 40. So just few people are mentioned here. So there's some more photos on the other side of the screen. So they've been extensively working on this to make these things happen. Whatever the events which is happening today is all because of their efforts and, you know, their planning. And it is all because of their efforts to reach you to learn and acquire skills about EVs. Definitely thanks for all the community leads to making this happen. And I'll come to the point about courses, because I'm very sure that, you know, you're not here to listen about community, you know, what is Decibels and all these things, but I think you're definitely here to learn about technical things in EV, right? So I'll just take a minute here and a few minutes, maybe a couple of minutes to introduce about the course, and then I'll hand over the session to Venu, right? That's the whole plan as a technical part of the session. So as such, which you would know, electric vehicle contains a lot of components, like a powertrain of EV contains like a motor controller, then sometimes there's a transmission too, then there's a battery, there's a charger, there's a DC-DC converter. There's a lot of components, right? So specifically when you talk about a powertrain as a drivetrain, it's a motor and a transmission. Then the other side, there's a battery, and integrating all of them together with a motor controller. Now, when you want to build an EV, so the very first question comes to you is, okay, what should be the motor size, right? So what should be the battery size? If I charge the battery for for, let's say, like a 1 hour, how much should be the range I should get? Or to get a range of, let's say, 150 kilometers for a bike, what should be the battery size I should have? What should be the kilowatt of the battery pack size I should have? Or possibly if you want to get acceleration, let's say Ather promises 0 to 40 in 3.9 seconds. And if they want to achieve 0 to 60 in 3.9 seconds, what should be the motor size? And what should be the transmission gear ratio specifications, right? And then what should be the battery current required, right? Like, these are the very typical questions everybody gets in their mind. If you want to start, like somebody was discussing about, I want to build an electric three-wheeler. If you want to build a three-wheeler, okay, I want to decide upon that. And if I do a single charge, then the vehicle should at least come for 100 kilometers. But how do I do that, right? So there would be a weight on the weight of the vehicle. There's a weight of the battery, weight of all the motor components. Then there's a passengers also, right? Like, these passengers are not like single person. Like, sometimes there'll be three passengers, sometimes there'll be two passengers, right? And sometimes there will be even only one passenger, right? And the road conditions would be in one area would be different. And the road conditions, maybe another area is too hilly. Like, in some conditions, the traffic is too high, right? So there are a lot of conditions like that. So when we have all the situations which is going on in the city, so I want to actually, like, you know, calculate exactly the amount of battery size I require to, you know, calculate the components such as motor, maybe motor controller, battery pack size, charger, a lot of these components, right? So when you need to do all of these things, so first thing is the fundamentally the calculations, right? So that's where it is all starting, as the first and very first step. So the idea for this whole course, like, you know, when I just run through some of these diagrams here, that, you know, you see there's a motor. For the motor, there's a specific type of graphs. There's an efficiency region for the graphs. You know, there's a very unique things which we have to consider, because if you have to design an EV, because everybody can just build an EV, you know, assemble components and let's say it runs. But the idea is, like, you know, that everybody can do it. But as an engineer, there is a very deeper tech in building an EV, that, you know, we need to optimize the components to make them function at a very highest level of efficiencies, right? But that's what we as engineers and we as simulation engineers engage and, you know, involve in the activities to develop EVs, which are more optimally designed, okay? So the first step of all these things is actually the calculations, okay? So how we could do the hand calculations and arrive at some of the component sizing, and then how we can perform simulations using a simulation software such as Scilab, or a Matlab, or any of the similar softwares of that sort. Okay. So idea here is, I'm just running through these few images. Now you have a motor, there's a motor nominal torque, there's a motor peak torque, there's a motor nominal current, there's a motor peak current, the motor power, the motor motor RPM, motor operating points as an efficiency. Like, all these things will come into a picture. And same way, if you consider about an inverter, then again, inverter, there's a specific sizing for the inverter. What should be the maximum current the inverter can handle? What switching frequency, does it connect to a regenerative braking? Like, all these parameters will come into our picture in the motor controller. Then again, come to a battery pack, you know, we have a number of cells and all these things. And coming to a very larger picture, what should be the kilowatt of the battery pack? It means, like, you know, if I have this sized battery pack, then the vehicle will give me a specific range, right? So a very general definition of that. So we have to define the number of, then once you define a pack size, you will define number of cells required, series, parallel, all these configurations into a place. So we need to figure out all these things, right? So like this and similar, there is a transmission and so many other components. So if you want to arrive at specific information, like talking about a motor, what will the motor torque, motor RPM, then if you have to use a transmission, what the exact gear ratios we need to use. And then we're talking about a motor controller, again, motor controller currents, and, like, you know, the peak currents, nominal currents of a motor controller. Then if you talk about a battery, the battery size as such in kilowatt, and maybe the current at the battery, and to make all these things happen, the number of cells required in series, the number of cells required in parallel. Right? This is a whole thing everybody does at an industry too. So now the objective of this course is actually to provide you that learning to do the calculations, to get a very solid understanding of these calculations into our place. So with that motive, we have this course. By end of the course, you would have very much clarity on actually how do you have to calculate all the, you know, forces acting on the vehicle. How do you arrive at specific numbers, okay? And this is the static calculation. We will teach you the dynamic part of the calculations in the very last of it using some simulation softwares, all right? So to do this session as a part of it, we have two speakers. That would be Venu. So Venu is a co-founder and a powertrain head at Decibels Lab. is also part of a KTH racing team and a KTH Hyperloop team in Sweden. So right now he's delivering the session from Sweden. And welcome to you, Venu, and thanks for joining in for the session to share your knowledge. And so it would be me, who's Suraj. I would be joined with Venu in the middle of the session to you know, here and there to help you out. So I am part of Decibels, founding team at Decibels. So I worked a few of the projects in Mercedes in the past and also in Chrysler through a company called ITC Infotech. So we've worked on AMG GTR projects and also projects in US with Chrysler on Jeep Wrangler, many of those product lines. So that's bit of my area. Definitely, as I said, this is not about knowing Decibels and knowing speakers. It's definitely about learning EVs. Yeah. So that's the way I think we could get to know each other. And that's bit of the two speakers interaction. Not much too much of GAN here. So I would hand over the session to Venu to take over the session. Venu, over to you to take up the session.
Thanks, Suraj.
Thank you. Yeah, I think you're good to share the screen, Venu.
First thing, am I audible?
I think, yeah, you're audible, Venu.
And can you see my screen?
Yeah, we can see the screen in YouTube Live too, yes.
Okay, cool. So, welcome to the session, guys. Very good morning to everyone. So, today we'll be discussing more about the vehicle performance analysis. So we don't need to wait much time here to discuss about ourselves. We'll start directly into the concept. So today's agenda will be something like this. I'll be starting with some very basic introduction to the vehicle performance analysis, and then I'll be discussing regarding the motion resistance. What exactly is the motion resistance? What are the tests that will be conducted to determine this resistance forces acting on the vehicle? And next we'll discuss like what are the factors that affect this vehicle performance and to what extent they will affect the vehicle performance. And we'll discuss some hand calculations related to the Ather bike, Ather 450. And we'll have like small Q&A question and answer session. Okay. So yeah, starting with, so here you can see like a vehicle performance analysis that's on the top. So what exactly mean by the vehicle performance? So let's say you're planning to buy one bike or some car. One of your friend will come and ask you why you are buying that particular bike. You will be telling that, okay, it's having good power performance, or it is having like a durability and safety, or it's having like a fuel economy. So you'll say like many reasons. It is stylish, or it is giving a high mileage and all these things. Okay, so this all comes under the vehicle performance. So let's say like there are three important parameters that tells you like, okay, these are the three important things that to be discussed when you are telling vehicle performance. One is like power performance, the durability and safety, and the fuel economy. Okay, so today we'll be mainly concentrating on the two points. One is power performance and the fuel economy. So what exactly the power performance tell you? Let's say one thing is like max vehicle speed. If your vehicle want to reach like 100 kmph, or if your vehicle wants to reach max speed of like 140 or 180 kmph, that depends upon the power that is delivered by the power producing unit in the vehicle. Maybe it might be, if you take combustion vehicle, it is the engine along with the gasoline. If you take the electric vehicle, it will be the motor along with the battery pack. Okay, so it depends upon those parameters. Next, if you tell like acceleration time, how much time my vehicle is taking to reach a particular speed, let's say like 0 to 100 kmph, it is taking, let's say, 10 seconds. Okay. So if you say like my vehicle is more power performance, it means that it has to take very less time to reach high velocities. It is a main important parameter coming to the race car teams, because they want to achieve high velocities within the less time. So that plays a very important role in one of the vehicle performance analysis. And the third thing is like gradability. Okay, every vehicle can go as fast as possible on the flat roads, but what about the inclined roads? Okay. So if you take like some dirt races, there will be having like uneven roads, and we'll be having sometimes the gradability also. So there the real power comes. So if your vehicle has to be on the top on the race, then you have to consider all these three parameters: max vehicle speed, acceleration time, and the gradability. But when we are discussing about the family cars, then we don't need like a gradability and all these things, because we'll be using the family cars just for going to the office and coming back to the normal purpose. We don't need like that much of performance or acceleration or gradability. But coming to the family cars, we need like a fuel economy. So how much of fuel it is consuming, or how much of range it is giving. So this plays a very important role when we are discussing in terms of the family cars. Okay. So this is the main difference between the race car and the family cars. So when we are discussing mainly about the race cars, the battery pack is different from the family cars. So in race cars, we'll be using like a high power battery packs, and whereas in the normal family cars, we'll be using like energy battery packs, not power-based battery packs, but energy-based battery packs. So again, these parameters, the power performance parameters, depends upon like some of the resistive force acting on the vehicle. So let's say like you started from your home and you are going to your office. So in the middle, there is like a wind. So this wind might affect your vehicle performance. Let's say like you are having some gradability in the middle of the road. So this gradability also will affect your vehicle performance. So there are many parameters which affects your vehicle movement when you're moving from point A to point B. Okay. So out of all those parameters, there are mainly four important parameters that has to be discussed. One is rolling resistance, grade resistance, aerodynamic force, acceleration, and inertia forces. Okay. So these are the four important forces. And these four forces, each again depends upon like some of the parameters. If you can look at over here, the rolling resistance, it depends upon many parameters such as like CRRR, which is a coefficient of rolling resistance. And it depends upon the tire properties such as like tire pressure, tire size, tire weight, and contact area of the tire. So this, and it also depends upon the vehicle weight. Okay. The next thing is like grade resistance. It depends upon the inclination and the vehicle weight. And the third one, which is very important thing, aerodynamic force. It depends upon like drag coefficient, frontal area of the vehicle, air density, vehicle velocity, and also it depends upon like other parameters of the shape of the vehicle. Okay. And the fourth, acceleration force. It depends on the mass of the vehicle, acceleration, and inertia components. Okay. So in brief, we'll discuss these things in the coming slides about each and every constant, how they are calculated and everything. But the test that is used to calculate these kind of constants is nothing but the coast down test. There are other some of the tests, something like CFD simulations, or we'll be doing something called as a wind tunnel test to get to these coefficient values. Coming to the fuel economy side, it also again depends upon like vehicle parameters as well as battery pack parameters. Coming to the battery pack parameters, it depends like cell voltage, cell capacity, specific energy, and specific power. Why exactly I'm mentioning these four things is like cell voltage varies for different battery technologies. Let's say like lead acid, it will be like 1.2. And lithium ion technology, it is like nominal is 3.6. So this voltage variation plays a very important in the whole battery pack voltage. And if you select lead acid, your battery pack weight will be more, which means indirectly your performance of the vehicle will be decreasing. Especially if you talk about race car teams, each and every kg of the vehicle plays a very important role. So that's the reason like selection of the cell, particular cell plays a very important role. And the capacity, the third one is specific energy. So if you take the electric vehicles, why we are mainly back of high specific energy cells, because the range of the vehicle depends upon this specific energy. If you want more range, you have to select the cells which are having high specific energy. And if you want to have like high performance in terms of max vehicle speed or gradability or acceleration time, then we have to select the cells which are having high specific power. That's the reason I mentioned over here the four important points. And next, coming to the vehicle parameters, of course, it depends upon the mass of the vehicle and all these parameters which we have discussed over here. Okay. So this is basically about the vehicle performance analysis. So whenever we are going to create or designing a new vehicle, first of all, we have to understand all these terms, and then we have to start with the designing the vehicle. So yeah, motion resistance. What exactly the mean name of the, I mean, like the name is describing. So if you see here, the motion resistance, we all know that what do you mean by resistance? It is just like opposing force, or it's just opposing some of the motion. Okay. So here, if you see here, there are two types of vehicles. One is on the inclined road and the second one is on the flat road. Okay. So whenever the vehicle is moving in some direction, let's say X direction, there will be some forces. So this is the X direction and this is the Y direction. So whenever the vehicle starts moving in a particular direction, there will be some forces which will be acting on the vehicle in the opposite direction. The summation of all these forces which are acting on the vehicle in the opposite direction to the vehicle movement, they are called as resistive forces. And what is the main aim of these resistive forces is to decrease the vehicle performance or vehicle velocity. Okay, so they're called as negative forces. And there will be a component which is called as a traction force, which is produced by the power producing unit in the vehicle. So that is the positive force. Okay. Is on the left hand side, which is on the inclined road. So this basically we'll be using this terminology in our calculations. So if you see over here, there are like longitudinal components and the vertical components. And what are the forces that are acting in the negative longitudinal direction is the forces which are represented in the green color. They are called as rolling resistance forces. And the one which is represented over with the red arrow, it is the total positive force, which is called as the traction force. And the another component, if you see here, that is the aerodynamic force. The aerodynamic force will act at the center of gravity of the vehicle. Okay. And because of the inclination, the mass component or the weight component will be having a divided into two components, one along the movement of the direction and another along the vertical component. Okay. So because of this two components, sometimes it might help you with the movement of the vehicle. I mean, it gives more performance to the vehicle. Let's say like when you're coming down the hill, your vehicle will be running at high speeds. That's because of addition of this a gravity component. And when you're going up the hill, your vehicle performance will be decreasing. That's because of this vehicle component, which is acting in the opposite direction to the vehicle. Okay. So that's one of the reason. And if you look at the another force Fi over here, that is the inertia force, which will be acting in the direction of the vehicle movement because acceleration will be net of this traction force and this resistance force. Okay, so mainly these are the forces which will be acting on the vehicle. And as I told you, there are different forces and to what contribution they will be contribute, we'll see over here. So each and every component in the vehicle will contribute to the motion resistance. Let's say like drivetrain components. So first of all, when I'm saying like drivetrain components, there are like two main things to be understand. What is one is a powertrain and drivetrain. Okay. So drivetrain includes like drive shafts, gearbox, differentials, and the wheels. Whereas when I'm speaking about the powertrain, it includes the power producing unit plus the drivetrain components, which means that motor along with the battery pack and the drive shafts, gearbox or differential and the wheels. Okay, that's called as the powertrain components. So here the drivetrain components are corresponding around like 5 to 10% of the rolling resistance or running resistance. And the brake pads, which will be having on the wheels, brake disc. So they are corresponding to like 4 to 5% of total running resistance. And the other important thing is like wheel hubs, they correspond to like 2 to 4%. And the other important things were like rolling resistance and aerodynamic resistance. These place a higher amount of effect on the motion. They correspond to like 35 to 45% coming to the rolling resistance and aerodynamic resistance of like 45 to 55%. Because of this, why we have to discuss about these things is like, because of these forces, your vehicle performance will be decreasing. And of course, your energy consumption from the battery pack will be increasing. Okay. So this is also another important parameter, that is energy consumption. So yeah, now I spoke like all the resistance forces are some of the things. It will be very difficult to visualize all these things. So So just I will show you a video or two videos on particular these things. One thing is like it will give you a clear idea on how exactly they will do the tests to calculate this kind of forces acting on the vehicle. And also there's another test which is conducted to determine the coefficient of drag and aerodynamic assessment of the vehicle. Okay, so these two videos will give you like a clear idea, okay, what we are going to learn or what we are going to do today, okay? I hope the audio is coming.
No, we don't. Audio is not coming.
Okay, cool. So this is the test they'll be conducting to determine the resistance forces acting on the vehicle and to what percent they'll be acting on the vehicle. So this is the test bed where they kept the vehicle and they were running it. Sorry for the audio problem. Maybe at the end of the session, I can show you the same with audio. So yeah, so from this video, what all things we can take is like, first they have done some practical test, real-time testing of the vehicle. So from that, if you see like, from the real-time testing, they have collected some of the data. Let's say like they collected some tire parameters and they collected like vehicle velocity versus the forces acting on the vehicle. And they have plotted some of the graphs, how the rolling resistance of the vehicle is varying with respect to time and with respect to velocity. Similarly, like how much amount of this drivetrain components or the brake pads and other wheel hub parameters were contributing to the rolling resistance. After that, what they have done is like they have developed a simulation model where they can study for each and every vehicle. It's very difficult to test each and every vehicle, right? So what they will do is like they will develop the simulation models, okay? And after the simulation model, they will study like each and every parameter for different drive cycles. Okay. So similarly, what we have done is like we have tested one vehicle. So we calculated the vehicle from point A to point B and we generated like the drive cycle for that. And for that particular drive cycle, what are the forces acting on the vehicle and what is the energy consumption that is taking place? So that's what we have done. And we have simulated that in the simulations. Okay. I will show you the simulations which we have developed in the last of the session. Okay. So the next video, which I'm going to show you, gives a clear idea on like aerodynamic assessment. Now we have seen like rolling resistance assessment. The other important thing is like aerodynamic assessment. So yeah, so this video will give you a clear idea on like how exactly they are going to measure like aerodynamic assessment or how they're going to estimate the drag of the vehicle, because the drag plays a very important role. As I told you, they'll be using some test called as wind tunnel test. So this is a wind tunnel test they're conducting to determine the drag for the particular vehicle which they are showing. Why we have to do this is because the air flowing across the vehicle plays a very important role in what way it is flowing and how much of a variation it is creating in terms of drag. Because here it is just for like a inside testing, like we are testing it inside a particular box or something. But if you bring it to the real case scenario on the vehicle, on the road, we will be having like different vehicles or bikes and everything besides us. So that also plays a very important role in this particular assessment. So that's what they are showing, open road versus the wind tunnel test. And they're at the same time, they're telling like, what is the difference between those two tests? Okay, so now you might get like clear idea on how exactly they'll be doing the test to determine the rolling resistance assessment and the aerodynamic assessment. Okay, so now we'll discuss like what exactly is the rolling resistance and all these forces. So the first one is the rolling resistance. It is the amount of force that is acting on the vehicle. And it's because of the vehicle motion. And it's also because of the rolling resistance, rolling motion between the wheels and the surface of motion of the vehicle. It is usually calculated as gross vehicle weight into coefficient of rolling resistance into cos theta, where this cos theta determines the inclination of the road. If you're going in the flat road, the cos theta will be zero. So cos zero is zero, one. So that the rolling resistance can be calculated as gross vehicle weight into coefficient of rolling resistance. Next is the grade resistance. It is because of the inclination, and it might help you during the descending the inclination, and it will create a problem when you're going up the hill. And it is calculated as gross vehicle weight into sine theta. So, and again, when there is no inclination, there won't be any grade resistance. The third is aerodynamic force. It's because of the air molecules which are present in the atmosphere will create a pressure on the vehicle. And it is calculated as half rho CD AV square. And the fourth, which is the acceleration, it's because of the acceleration of the vehicle. And it's calculated as mass into acceleration, which is Newton's second law. Okay. And then another parameter that is traction force, which is the positive force, and it is generated by the power producing unit in the vehicle. And the total net force available will help you in the propulsion. So here the net force used for vehicle propulsion is nothing but the positive force which is produced by the vehicle minus the resistive forces which are acting on the vehicle. Okay, so yeah, now we'll go in depth about the rolling resistance. Okay, so as I told you, this rolling resistance is caused because of the rolling motion between the wheels and the surface motion of the vehicle. So it depends upon like many parameters such as a coefficient of rolling resistance of the tire, and depends upon the vehicle weight. It also depends upon the tire parameters. Okay, so if you look at over here, this is the tire and it is moving in this particular direction. So whenever the tire is moving in the particular direction, so initially in idle case, we know that our tire will be something like this. It won't be having any flat base, right? So the contact area will be very less. But when the vehicle start moving, or let's say like when it is static also, it will be having something like this, flat curve. But when the vehicle starts moving, it will form like leading edge and trailing edge in the tire. Okay, so the tire carcass will form like leading edges and trailing edges. If you see here, that I have represented with the red color upward arrows. And actually, whenever we talk about the forces acting on the tire, let's say normal force W by 4, which is nothing but for each wheel I'm talking about here, total weight of the vehicle be W, and the weight acting on a single tire or single wheel will be divided by 4 if you're talking about the four wheelers. Okay, so here the W by 4 is the normal force which is acting on the tire in the downward direction. So according to Newton's law, for each and every force, there has to be opposite force. So here it has to be the ground force, which is acting in the same direction, sorry, in the same axis, but in the opposite direction. So it has to be something like this. But because of this leading edge and trailing edge formation, the pressure distribution of the tire will move to the forward direction, I mean like towards the forward of the tire. And it will, if you look at here, it is just forming a curve here. In the leading edge of the vehicle, it is having more pressure compared with the trailing edge. Okay, so because of this pressure difference, the normal force which has to act along the axis, center of the axis of the wheel, but it shifts with an offset of distance E. Okay, so because of this offset distance, the moment will be developed in the wheel. Okay, so this is acting in this particular direction and this is acting in this particular direction with an offset distance E. So two opposing force, but not in the same axis, will create the moment. Okay, so that's why I've written here the moment equation at the center of the tire. So Fz is the normal force acting on the tire, and E is the offset distance. So if you look at it, Fz into E, and FRR is the rolling resistance force that we are going to calculate into RR, where RR represents the rolling radius of the tire. Okay, so the tire will be having two types of radius. One is called as a static radius, and another one is called as a rolling radius or dynamic radius. So dynamic radius will be different from the static radius. Okay, and from this equation we can calculate the what is the total amount of forces because of this moment is causing. So FRR equal to Fz into E divided by RR. Okay, so I am representing this E by RR as CRR, which is nothing but quotient of rolling resistance. So many people might be having the doubt that why exactly this pressure distribution is happening, because as I told you that it depends upon the tire material also. Okay, if you consider here, a tire will be having like viscoelastic materials. So what exactly this viscoelastic material is, that first we'll discuss what is a purely elastic material, and then we'll go with the viscoelastic material. If you look at the purely elastic material, during the load and unloading cases, it is following the same path, which means that there is no energy absorbed during the loading and unloading cases. Okay, but if you observe here for the viscoelastic materials, during the load case, it is following this particular path. But during the unload cases, it is following something called as parabola. Okay. So actually, during the load cases, the area represents the total amount of energy. So it is nothing but the area of the triangle over here. But during unloading case, the red lines, the red vertical lines represents the energy returned. Okay, so the blue returns the energy absorbed. So because of this energy absorbed, this pressure distribution is taking place in the tire. And because of this pressure distribution in the tire, the force which has to act in the center of the axis, it is shifting towards the front of the tire with an offset distance E. So which is creating a moment in the tire. So this moment will oppose the direction of wheel movement, which is nothing but the this moment we are considering in terms of forces. That's why it is called as rolling resistance force. And we will call all these things as hysteresis losses. So that's the main reason behind this rolling resistance force generation. And as I told you that it also depends upon like quotient of rolling resistance. So different roads will be having different quotient of rolling resistance values. So that I presented over here, the table over here. concrete road is having like a 0.015 as a CRR value for different, I mean, like a good, fair and poor values for also here. So like this, I will be doing taking the values because they are already tested values. You can directly take these values for your vehicle parameters. So nowadays, like all the vehicles will be having a tire rolling resistance coefficient of 0.015 or less than that. Okay, so it also plays a very important role because it consumes like 30% of fuel consumption is because of rolling resistance. So if you look at over here, I mentioned some of the tire image over here, and it's showing something like one is fuel economy and the conditions of the road and all these things. I will discuss like what tire parameters plays a very important role in this rolling resistance generation. So yeah, if you see here, like all the tires were rated from A to G. Okay, A means like it will be having less fuel consumption, which means that a high efficiency will be there. Whereas if you are taking like a G type of tire, it will be having like a more fuel consumption and less fuel efficiency. Okay, so if you observe the difference between these two tires, A type and G type, it's almost like 7.5% of fuel consumption will vary. Okay, and coming to the noise levels, there will be a difference of like 6 decibels when we are comparing with the A and G values. And also like, grip. So 18 meters, approximately like 18 meters of stopping distance can be changed between the A and G type of tires. Okay, so here if you use like A type of tires, we can save like approximately 6 liters of fuel for every like 1,000 kilometers, something like that. So why you have to save the fuel? Because nowadays everyone is back of sustainability. Like we need to decrease the carbon footprints in our environment are to bring out like a sustainability in the transportation. Okay, so sustainability is nothing but a decrease in the carbon footprints and also the decrease in the noise levels and all these things. So how we can contribute to that is like selecting the proper tires for our vehicle. So helps in bringing the sustainability. So what I want to tell over here is that selecting A type of tires will consume less amount of energy compared with G type of tires. And also it will create you like less noise levels and all the things. And also it will give like shorter stopping distance. So that's the main aim of this particular tire classification. And the other things is like tire parameters such as tire pressure. So let's say like we are having less tire pressure in the tire. So at that point of time, our tire will be something like this. It will be having some flat area. So what will happen is if you are having the flat area, your contact area with the road, contact area will increase. If you are increasing the contact area with the road, the resistance force, which is nothing but roll FRR, will increases. So what we'll do is like we have to maintain proper tire pressure such that you'll be having something like this. You'll be having point contact with the road. If you're having point contact with the road, your FRR will be very less. Okay, so that's the reason if you observe when you're going with on a vehicle, suddenly if your tire gets punctured, you'll be having some noise coming out of that particular tire, right? And also your performance will be decreasing. These are the main reasons. So to make sure that your tire is having like proper pressure such that you'll be having less rolling resistance force and also like less noise levels. And here, keep the comparison tables for how the coefficient of rolling resistance varies with respect to car speed and tire pressure. So the first one is for like a tire pressure of 1 bar, and the brown one, which is very down, it is for the tire pressure of 4 bar. Okay. So for tire pressure of 1 bar, if you observe the coefficient of rolling resistance is 0.015. And for 4 bar of tire pressure, the coefficient of rolling resistance is like approximately 0.01. Okay. So because of this small variation, let's say like mass of the vehicle is 200 kgs. So now the rolling resistance force because of these two things is like 200 into 9.81 into 0.015 and Another one is this first case, and the another case is like 200 into 9.81 into 0.008 or something like that. Okay. So if you observe here, the difference 0.015 and 0.08. So this will create a rolling distance post difference. Okay. So maintaining proper pressure will give you like a best performance. And as I told you that many people know think that the rolling distance is independent of velocity, but it's not. It depends upon the velocity of the vehicle also. But what I can tell you is like for a particular period of velocity range, it will remain the constant. But after the particular velocity, it will be having some linear velocity range, linear variation. Okay. So for vehicle performance analysis, what we can do is like we can take it as a constant, which means that this coefficient of rolling resistance or rolling resistance force is not varying with respect to velocity on to 100 kmph or 110 kmph. But when we are crossing above this velocity, we have to consider it as a linear variation. Okay. And the another thing in this graph, what I want to present is like selecting the tires for different regions. So for example, if you are going to design a vehicle for concrete roads, then you have to make sure that your tire is having more pressure. But if you take this more pressure tire to the Rajasthan places where we are having the desert. So in that place, because of this less contact area, it will go deep into the soil, right? So when it is going deep into the soil, what will happen is like your performance will be decreasing. So for that, what we can take the best example is that difference between the horse and the camel. So the camel give you like more performance in the desert, but not on the road. Whereas horse can give you more performance on the road, but not in the desert areas, because horse will be having less contact area, less foot contact area. So when we take this horse to the desert, is the horse legs will be going deep into the soil, and it's very difficult for the horse to go as fast as possible. Okay. So similarly, if you compare this logic with the vehicles, so whenever you are designing the vehicle for desert areas, you have to make sure that the vehicle tire pressure is less, or we have to select the tires which are having like a more contact area or more flatness, which means that section width of the tire is more compared to the normal tires for the normal roads. Okay, so that's what this graph is telling. So this is for the sand, and this is for the medium hot soil and concrete soil. And these are the pressure levels. Okay, so the y-axis representing the coefficient of rolling resistance, and the x-axis is representing the pressure of the tire. So this is mainly about the rolling resistance. I hope you got a clear idea on like what exactly is the rolling resistance and how it is affecting the vehicle performance. So the next is like grade resistance. As I told you that it's because of the gravity components when we are traveling on the inclined roads. So it will be having like two components. So let's say this is the center of gravity, gross vehicle weight. So it will be having two components. So the one along the opposite to the direction of the vehicle is called as a gross vehicle weight sine theta, and vertical component is a gross vehicle weight cos theta. Okay, so this component will helps the vehicle movement when we are coming down the hill, and this component will oppose the motion when we are going up the hill. Okay, so that is then more is the inclination of the road, more will be your grade resistance, and more will be the power required from the power producing unit. Okay, so there are some like according to the government regulations, if you see over here, two wheelers with fixed transmission ratio and engine capacity not exceeding 70 cc, so it must be able to climb the gradability of like 3.81 degrees when the vehicle is in stationary condition. Let's say like this is your inclined surface, so this is theta, and we kept the vehicle over here. So I'm representing the vehicle as a block. So now we have to make sure that this vehicle, if the, we have to make sure that the vehicle has to move. Okay. So this is 3.81 degrees. So according to government regulations, with a fixed transmission, so the vehicle has to overcome of overcome an angle of 3.81 degrees. And for all other vehicles, it is like 7 degrees. And now I think the government regulation has been changed to like 85 cc. I mean, like this is the cubic, this represents the capacity of the engine or proprietary engine unit. But if you come to the electric vehicles, it will be something different. So for a normal family cars, I think it is now 14 degrees it has become. So yeah, you can refer to the amendment number 3 made 2002 for more details about this gradability of the Indian roads. Okay, they have mentioned like how to measure the particular gradability of the roads, and also like how to take the weight components and all the things. But yeah, so this is mainly about the grade resistance. It's only because of the inclination. Okay, so coming to the formula race car tracks or F1 race car tracks, there won't be any gradability because all those tracks were like flat road tracks. So there the grade resistance doesn't play a very important role. But when we are talking about like commercial vehicles or family cars, yeah, we have to consider a little bit of grade resistance, let's say up to 14 degrees. Okay. Yeah, the third very important parameter, that is the aerodynamic force. So as I told you, this is because of the air molecules which are present in the vehicle, in the atmosphere. So because of this air molecules, there will be two types of forces that will be generated. One is called as a drag force and another one is like a lift force. Okay. So if you see here, this is the center of gravity. The green point represents center of gravity. And here the red, which represents the drag, it opposes the vehicle motion. And if you see here, the down force, this is the blue, which will helps the, like we'll be having another component called as a lift force. Okay. So when the vehicle is moving in this direction, the air will be moving in this particular direction. So all these air molecules will try to go under the vehicle and it will try to lift the vehicle. Okay. So in that case, what we need is like, we need more down force. Okay. So if you're having more down force, then it is possible to achieve like high accelerations and high velocities. But whereas this drag component will oppose the vehicle motion. Okay. So what I want to bring out here is like, this drag component depends upon. So actually the aerodynamic force is represented as a half rho CD A V square. So this CD is called as a drag component and it is measured as the same formula, writing it inversely, FA rho divided by 0.5 rho A V square. Okay. So what we can do is like, we'll be doing some test called as a wind tunnel test or CFD simulation to get this CD value. And then we'll be going to estimate this aerodynamic force. Otherwise, like, there are two ways of doing this thing. First, we can do the simulations for energy estimations and we'll keep the target. Let's say like, I want to achieve like 2 kilowatt of battery pack consumption for this particular race track. Okay. So for that 2 kilowatt of battery pack, we'll be getting some CD value. Okay. Then we'll give the CD value to the CFD simulation department. They will try to decrease frontal area of the vehicle or a structure of the vehicle to achieve that particular CD value. That's how it has to be. So it has to both way. It has to work like CFD simulation. They will give you some data and you have to test with that particular data and you'll be getting some energy consumption. Then if you think your energy consumption is more, then you have to tell them, okay, I'm getting this much amount of energy consumption more than my expectations. So can you please reduce the structure of the, changes in the structure of the vehicle and bring this CD value less so that the energy consumption will decrease. Okay. So that's how this CD plays a very important role. And the another one is like a frontal area. So what exactly the frontal area represents is like the area of the vehicle. So if you see here in this image, so let's say like, this is the YZ plane and this is the XY plane. On the XY plane, we are placing the whole vehicle. And now we are passing some razor light or something through this vehicle. So on the back of the screen, we'll be getting the shadow or we'll be getting like the whole image of the vehicle. So if you measure the area of this particular thing, so this is called as frontal area of the vehicle. So when we are doing this frontal area estimation, we have to keep all the things open like mirrors or whatever extra components we're having on the outer side of the vehicle. Okay, because mirrors also plays a very important role. And in the tires also, if you keep an extra parts, we have to keep them so that it will be also getting calculated in the frontal area of the vehicle. Okay. So product of these two, CD into A, plays a very important role in the energy consumption. Okay. So from years onwards, from let's say like this drag coefficient variation takes place from 1920s and still it's going on. And still the research is going on this to reduce like drag coefficient values. In 1920s, we are having approximately like, if you see over here. So here somewhere around this point, we are having like a drag coefficient of approximately one for this particular vehicle. These are like aerodynamic structures. We are having some basic aerodynamic structures. So based on the aerodynamic structures, they modified the vehicle shapes and finally they got to like a 0.14 for Ford Probe V. But now the commercial vehicles which we are using now, it's having in the range of like 0.22, 0.24, 0.26. So that's the present coefficient of drag values we are achieving. And now I'm speaking only in terms of like cars, performance cars. But if you take for like heavy trucks, or for two wheelers, this coefficient of drag will be varying. Let's say like Ather, it is published on their website that it is having like 0.2 to something coefficient of drag value. But for trucks, it will be too high because the trucks will be almost having like a square shape of frontal area. It will be having square shape, right? So because of that, we'll be having more drag coefficient. So whenever we are designing the vehicle structure, it's better to go through the basic aerodynamic structures available. And based on that, we have to determine the shapes. Let's say, look at over here. The top layer of here, it represents one aerodynamic foil. And the down layer also, it represents another aerodynamic foil. Okay. So that's how they modified the shapes. And now they come up with a 0.2 or 0.24 values. So if you look at over here, Tesla Model S is having like 0.24. Mercedes-Benz is having like 0.22. And Volkswagen XL1 is having like 0.19, okay? And Hyundai Santro Hybrid is having like 0.25. Toyota Prius is having 0.25. So still they are working on, still research work is going on regarding the CD to decrease the CD values, okay? So if you look at over here, for a flat plate, it is like 1.95. So this flat plate type of structure can be observed in the trucks. That's why the trucks will be having more drag coefficient. And this is the airfoil structure, which is having 0.007. Okay. So if you can bring this kind of structure, so we'll be achieving like very less drag coefficient. So I hope this gives a clear idea on the drag coefficient values and how they're affecting. So apart from this drag coefficient and other things, so how this aerodynamic force is acting on the vehicle? So it's mainly acting because of the three components. One is skin friction drag, pressure drag, and interference drag. Okay. So first we'll discuss what exactly is the pressure drag. And next we'll discuss like what is the skin friction. Okay. So let's say this is your vehicle. So now it is moving in this particular direction, travel direction this is, and this air will be moving in this particular direction, right? So whatever the air moving in the opposite direction, first it directly interacts with the front part of the vehicle, right? So as it is interacting directly with the front part of the vehicle, the pressure on the front side will be more, okay? But it takes some time to reach the rear part. So what will happen is in the rear part, low pressure region will be developed. So this is the high pressure region in the front and this is the low pressure region in the back. Okay. So what happens because of these two pressure regions? We know that air or anything, it flows from high pressure region to the low pressure region. Now this high pressure region tries to flow back to the low pressure region. When it is moving to the low pressure regions, what it will do is like it will push the vehicle backwards. Okay, so it will tries to push the back so that what will happen is like if you're moving at a velocity of V, vehicle velocity is V, then the air also will push the vehicle with the velocity of V only. If the wind is more in the opposite direction, then it will be like a V plus VW, which is nothing but velocity of the vehicle plus velocity of the wind. Okay, so in that case, we'll be achieving like a deaccelerations. Let's say like you're going from your home to your office. Okay. So in the middle, you got like windstorm or something, high winds were there. Then the wind, velocity of the wind is greater than the velocity of the vehicle, for sure you'll be achieving like lower velocities. Okay, so that's because of the pressure regions developed before the vehicle and back of the vehicle. Okay, so that's about the pressure drag. And the next one is like skin friction drag. So let's say this is our vehicle. So around the vehicle will be having the air molecules, right? So what will happen if you are having the air molecules? If the two air molecules are moving at different velocities, because of this velocity difference, when they are moving at different velocities, the pressure, the friction will be developed between these two molecules. Let's say like this one air molecule and this is another air molecule. Because of this velocity difference, let's say it's moving in this direction and it is moving in this direction. Because of these two directions and because of the velocity difference, there will be friction developed between these two air molecules. Similarly, these are the air molecules which will get interacted with the surface of the vehicle. Okay, so with this surface, what will happen is the friction will be generated between the air molecules and the surface of the vehicle. That's why we have to make sure that our vehicle surface has to be as smooth as possible. So that what will happen is like the friction developed between the air molecules and this surface will be less and it won't create much resistive force on the vehicle. Okay, that's about the skin friction drag. And the interference drag is like whenever the vehicle is getting interacted with the air molecules, then force will be generated in the front of the vehicle. That is called as interference drag. Okay, so main thing to be remembered over here is when vehicle is moving in this particular direction with a velocity v, and if air is moving in this opposite direction, and if the velocity of the wind is greater than the velocity of the vehicle with the vw, then during your aerodynamic force calculation, F aero equal to half rho cd av square. So instead of v here, we have to use v plus vw whole square. Okay, but when you are moving in this direction with the velocity v and your wind velocity is, let's say it is less, so in that case it will be v minus vw whole square. Okay, so now I am talking only in terms of a velocity which is acting in the opposite direction to the vehicle, but there will be some crosswinds. So crosswinds will be something like this, which will act at an angle to the vehicle. This also creates like forces on the vehicle. So then it can be divided into components. So it will be like Vd cos theta and Vd sin theta, Vw sin theta. Okay, so then the component which is acting in the direction of the vehicle, opposite direction of the vehicle, then we have to take that component only. Okay, it depends upon the shape of the, angle at which this wind acts on the vehicle. Okay, so this is how we have to consider the air forces acting on the vehicle. Okay, so that's about the velocity component, and we have discussed like frontal area and CD. The last important thing is air density, how it is going to affect the vehicle performance. Okay, so let's say like there are two cases. One is a rainy day and next is like sunny. Okay, we all know that during the rainy season there will be rains, and due to this rains, the density of the air molecules will be more. Density will increase. This is because of the air. Plus, we'll be having, if it is rainy season, we'll be having like a rain, right? So we'll be having density of water also. So these both will be acting on the vehicle. Okay, so in the formula, F equal to half rho cd av square, this rho component will be increasing and compared with the sunny day. When sunny day, as the temperature will be high, so the density of the air molecules will be less, and as we don't have like water, so this rho component will be very less. So it plays a very important role for race cars, for which particular racetrack we are designing. Let's say like Coimbatore track. In Coimbatore track, we'll be having always the sunny days, but we can't predict it. Let's say if we are having a rain on that particular day, we can't do anything. So it's better to do test for both, like rainy day and the sunny day. There will be little variation, but yeah, it's good to consider this these kind of variations also. And it will be good to understand like how much amount of energy consumption is varying on the rainy day and sunny day. Okay, on the rainy day, if you're having both like wind also, wind plus rain, then the effect will be more. Okay, so we have to consider all these kinds of tests. So these kind of tests will be done in the what you call labs, and they will predict the CD values like that. Okay, so yeah, this is about aerodynamic assessment of the vehicle. So now many people will be having the doubt that which formula we have to use to calculate the drag, because I'm using the same formula for both aerodynamic force calculation and drag estimation. I'm telling that F aero equal to half rho CD AB square. And I'm at the same time, I'm telling to calculate CD. I'm using the same formula, F aero divided by half rho AB square. Okay. So which thing has to be estimated first? Either F aero or the CD value. Okay. So as I told you before, there are like three tests that can be used to estimate these things. One is the coast down test, wind tunnel test, and CFD simulations. Okay. So what exactly will happen in the coast down test? Okay. So if you see over here, they're having some instruments attached to the vehicle. Okay. So they will take the real vehicle to the test track. So in the test track, they will conduct different types of tests. So first, from the initial state, they will accelerate the vehicle to max speed, let's say like 80 kmph. Then they'll keep the vehicle in the neutral condition, and it's left over to bring to the rest. Okay, so what exactly they're doing is like, initially they're accelerating the vehicle to a peak speed of 80 kmph, and after that they'll keep the vehicle in the neutral condition, which means that bringing the gears to the neutral, and then after they will remove their legs from the acceleration and brake pedals, and will leave the vehicle until it comes to the rest condition, which means that zero velocity. Okay, so now why the vehicle will come to the rest is because of the forces which are acting on the vehicle. Okay, so when the vehicle is at 80 kmph, we'll be having the aerodynamic force, more aerodynamic force, half rho CD AB square. V is very high, so of course we'll be having the aerodynamic force, and we also will be having like a rolling resistance, and if there is any gradability in the road, let's say like 2 or 3 degrees of gradient, then it also will be considered. Okay, so because of these forces acting on the vehicle tries to come to the rest very slowly, and from this we'll get like velocity profile. They will get like a velocity at each and every second, and also they can calculate the forces acting on the vehicle. Okay, so from that data they will try to calculate the CD value. Okay, so that is the one test. That's why it is called as coast and down test. So first they'll coast the vehicle, which means that accelerate the vehicle, and then they'll bring it to rest condition. So the next test setup is like a wind tunnel test, where what they will do is like they'll keep the vehicle stationary in the test lab, and they'll use like a wind tunnel or something called as nozzles. So they'll pass the, if you see over here, they'll pass the fumes over the vehicle. Okay, so they'll keep some instruments over here to measure the flow pressure of these things, something like pitot tubes or pressure measuring instruments. So here the pressure will be different compared with the pressure over here, and here if you see here the pressure will be different compared with the pressure over here. So if you see here, there is no even flow of air is taking place, so that's what is called as wake region. So we have to make sure that the wake region has to be very less, then only we'll be getting high velocities in the vehicle. Okay, so from these variations they will do some simulation test setups, and from that they'll calculate the CD value. That is one type of test, wind tunnel test. Whereas in CFD simulation, they will take a vehicle model, and they will try to pass like a fluid, or whatever the fluid you want to take air, you can take it. Otherwise, if you want to take water, whatever the fluid we can take, we'll do the CFD simulation and then we'll get the CD value. Okay. So after getting the CD value, we'll calculate the aerodynamic force. Okay. After calculating the aerodynamic force, we'll try to estimate the how much of energy it is consuming. If it is consuming more energy, then we'll try to tell them that CD estimation team that, okay, the whatever the value you are giving, it is giving like a high amount of energy consumption. So can you please modify the changes to the vehicle and do like that? So it is like both way happens. So yeah, this is how CD will be estimated. I think that's about the aerodynamic assessment of the vehicle and the drag coefficient estimation. So now I hope like you got a clear idea on these three important forces. One is rolling distance, grade rations, and aerodynamic forces. The next important force is like acceleration force. That is like what we say, it's because of the motion of the vehicle. Okay, it's nothing much to discuss in that particular force. If you're accelerating, if your acceleration is high, then the acceleration force also will be high. Okay, so if you look at over here, I just want to keep all the forces summation of so whenever I say like a road resistance, it is a summation of rolling resistance and grade resistance. Okay, because it's because of the road irregularities only, right? So this will be like a gross vehicle weight into quotient of rolling resistance cos theta plus gross vehicle weight into CRR into sine theta. Let's say theta is zero, which means the flat road, then it will become gross vehicle weight into CRR plus this will become sine zero is zero. So it will become only gross vehicle weight into quotient of rolling resistance. So whenever people are in the some literatures, if they say it as a road resistance, then it is summation of rolling resistance and grade resistance. Okay. So whatever the drive cycles we are having now, they are all like a road resistance. They have given already the velocity variation with respect to the gradability only. So again, we don't need to consider this gradability in those drive cycles. Okay. So what this particular graph is telling is like how this rolling or road resistance is varying with respect to velocity and how this aerodynamic force is varying with respect to velocity. So from the formula of aerodynamic force, we can directly say that it's varying quadratically because it is having V squared term in the formula. Okay. But whereas, as I told you, rolling resistance will be constant for a particular period of time, and then it will be having linear variation. And after that, we'll be having quadratic variation, right? So this constant variation will be up to like, let's say 80 kmph. And then after from 80 to 110, we'll be having some linear variation. And after 120 or 120 to 130 region, we'll be having the quadratic variation. So that's why I kept over here first, constant, linear, and the quadratic variation, okay? So if we add these two things, rolling resistance plus grade resistance and the aerodynamic force will give you the total force. Okay. So the total amount of force will almost will be having like a quadratic variation, the summation of all these force. Okay. So this total resistive force. Is a summation of rolling resistance, grade resistance, aerodynamic force, plus acceleration force. The summation of all these force will be having a quadratic variation with respect to time or with respect to velocity. Okay. So yeah, I hope, I think we have to take a small break over here for 5 minutes and then we'll start it again, because it will be too difficult to continuously, and it will be very difficult for you to sit in front of the screen and listen all these things. So we'll take a small break of 5 minutes and then we'll start. Meanwhile, I'll try to take some questions from the chats.
It will be too difficult to continuously, and it will be very difficult for you to sit in front of the screen and listen all these things. We'll take a small break of 5 minutes and then we'll start.
Yes, absolutely. I think, so for everybody out there attending the session.
Well, I'll try to take some questions from the chats. It will be too difficult to continue. And understand it will be very difficult for you to sit in front of the screen and listen all these things. So we'll take a small break of 5 minutes and then we'll start.
Yes, absolutely. I think, so for everybody out there attending the session.
Well, I'll try to take some questions from the chats. It will be too difficult to continue. And understand it will be very difficult for you to sit in front.
Sorry for that interruption. I don't know what's happening. It's behaving like that. So I'll try to take some questions from the chat box here.
Hi, Venu.
Hey, Suraj.
Hi. I think we have a question. I was trying to address most of the questions by the chat itself. So yeah, there's a one question. How can we calculate CG vehicle? CG of the vehicle without using the design software?
Sorry?
Okay. How can we calculate the center of gravity, the CG of the vehicle, okay, without using the design software?
Okay. So one thing is like making the vehicle as a like full square block or something like that, dividing the components. I mean, like without using the design software, you're asking, right? So then what you do is we have to divide the vehicle into components. Let's say like we are having this kind of structure for a vehicle. Okay. So when we are having this kind of structure, we'll be having some coordinates. So let's say we divide this particular body into two parts. It depends upon the vehicle structure. Again, I'm telling you. So for this, using the coordinates available or using the measurements you're having, you can find out the center of gravity with the basic, very basic formulas we are having. So for this, we'll get the center of gravity. And from this, you'll be getting the center of gravity. We know, right? IXS and IYY, IZZ. And also we know like IXY, IYZ, IZX. Okay, so we are having the formulas available for that. So using those formulas, we can calculate the center of gravity value if you're not using any design software. So this is how we'll be doing that. Dividing the whole vehicle into small components and doing these calculations.
Yeah, that's perfect, you know. I think, overall, that was the answer for the calculations of a CG. So there's other question. Want to know whether all these resistance force calculations same to IC and EV, or will there be a difference? So as I also understand, it should be the same, right? So there won't be any differences between IC engine part, like, you know, force calculations and EV force calculation.
Yes, exactly. There won't be like any change in that, because only the change we are doing for the combustion and the electric vehicle is that we are changing the power producing unit in the vehicle. We are just replacing the engine with the motor and the gasoline tank with the battery pack. Okay. So that's the one variation. But the thing is like, in terms of mass, it might change the values. And the other thing is like, in combustion drivetrain, we'll be using the gearboxes and we'll be having like more number of gears. So because of this, we'll be increasing the inertia and this might cause some more losses. But whereas coming to the electric vehicle, the gearbox is neglected, right? We'll be having directly the differential. So yeah, some of the small variations will be there. Apart from that, we can't observe like major changes between the combustion and the electric vehicle.
Yeah. That's good. I think there's one more question. Is it possible to calculate frontal area of two-wheeler without using the software?
Yes, without using the software to achieve like a frontal area of the vehicle, you have to just go with like a frontal height of the vehicle and the width of the vehicle. Let's say like max width, your vehicle, it's very difficult to keep it on the screen, like how exactly a vehicle looks. So let's say I'm taking like a block so that it will be easy to represent the vehicle. Okay, so when you keep this particular two-wheeler vehicle in this particular shape, like let's take the vehicle and keep it in this particular box, so we'll be having the max width at some point of let's say your steering wheel is having like more width, and at some point in the rear, at the where the rear person sitting, back person sitting, we'll be having some max width, right? So we have to consider that max width and the max height of the vehicle. Let's say like a scooty max height will be in the front only. So from your ground to the height of your scooty, like a dashboard. So that will be considered as a max height. If you know these two things, then product of those two things will be the frontal area of the vehicle. That is without the driver. But when the driver is sitting on the vehicle, we have to consider the height to the point where the driver is sitting. Okay, so that all comes under the frontal area of the vehicle. Yeah, I think that's the only way available.
Right. I think the couple of other questions, I've just tried to address them here. So I think the questions, Vinod, I think we're good to start the session back. Do you want a small break?
No, we'll start it. If everyone is ready, yeah, we'll start.
Okay. I think just give us a, like, hi, if everybody is back here, just message us. It's all good to start. I think we require a pen and paper for all the hand calculations. And the importance of all these things is, you know, there's a quiz in the LMS. After taking the quiz only, the certificate will be awarded. So the quiz will be added. It's already available, but yeah, it will be available to take the quiz by end of the session. I mean, after you complete the session, you would be able to take the quiz. So it is involving all the calculations, which is, we are going to do it here. There's a problem-based state, like problem-based questions, multiple choice questions and things like that. So after completing the quiz only, the certificate will be issued to all. So there are 22 questions. So kindly, you know, do note all the problems on your paper. It's not possibly just to get a certificate. I believe it is more to learn, you know, more to gain knowledge, because you're spending your valuable time, in a productive way. So that I believe by taking a note of it and, you know, making all the documentations for yourself would help you to actually solve these problems which are given in the quiz. And the certification can be also in, because there is no getaway with it. Only when the quizzes are completed, the certificate will be generated automatically. So please do take a note of things and have calculators and things like that. So I think we're good to start ahead. Go ahead, Vinu.
Yeah. So yeah, up to now, we have calculated the rolling resistance, grade resistance, and aerodynamic force. Okay, so next thing is like a tractive force. As I told you, like tractive force is the power that is the force that is generated by the power producing unit in the vehicle. Okay, so because of these two difference, we'll be getting the propulsion. Okay, let's say like your tractive force is like 1000 newtons, which is coming from the motor or the combustion engine, and your resistance force is developed because of this drive cycle might be like 700 newtons. Okay, so there is a difference of 300 newtons. This 300 newtons is nothing but your net force, which is used for the propulsion purpose. That's why here, if you see here, this is called as a net propulsion force, which is nothing but the acceleration force. Okay, so this causing the net force is causing the acceleration of the vehicle to move from point A to point B. So the difference is called as net propulsion force. And if you see here, like I have represented the net force as a mx double dot, which is nothing but acceleration force, and this is called as a inertia force, and we are converting this inertia force to the equivalent mass mj by using some of the simple calculations over here. First thing is to convert the equivalent inertia. Let's say like this is your motor and this is your gearbox or differential. It is connected to the wheels. Okay, so here we are having a J motor inertia, and this is the gearbox, and this is J wheel, which is having the J wheel inertia. So here I'm not considering like inertia of the shaft and all these things, because it might confuse you, but yeah, I'm majorly considering all these things. So one assumption to calculate the total equivalent inertia on the wheel side or the motor side is that we have to assume that power on the motor side or power on the wheel side is same without any losses. Okay, so that's why I'm considering both as same. If you see here, power one equal to power two. So we know that power equal to torque into omega. So T1 into omega 1 equal to, and similarly P2 equal to T2 into, sorry, this is a omega 2. Yeah, T2 into omega 2. Okay, so the torque can also be represented in terms of inertia, because torque equal to J into alpha, where J is inertia and alpha is angular acceleration. Okay, that's why I presented here as J1 into omega 1 dot. So here you have to understand what is omega 1 dot. I am representing in the dot state space equations. So alpha is nothing but angular acceleration. Omega is our angular speed. So d omega by dt is nothing but alpha. Okay, so this d omega by dt I am representing it as omega dot. Okay, and yeah, let's say like a equal to d square x by dt square. Okay, where x is the displacement and t is the time. So acceleration nothing but d square x by dt square, which is also equivalent to dv by dt. Okay, so this can be represented as x double dot, where x is the displacement, or it can be represented as v dot. Okay, so this is something like represented in the representing all the terms in state space. So that's why I'm using some dot state specifications over here. So j1 into omega 1 dot into omega 1, and similarly, and now I'm trying to calculate on the wheel side. That's why I'm taking j equivalent into omega 2 dot into omega 2. So as I told you, like both are equal, power, both powers are equal. I'm equating both and I'm trying to calculate j equivalent. So j equivalent equal to omega 1 dot divided by omega 2 dot into omega 1 by omega 2 and j1. Okay, so here gear ratio, motor angular speed is omega 1 and wheel angular speed is omega 2. So the gear ratio can be defined as omega 1 by omega 2. Or it can be also represented as omega 1 dot by omega 2 dot. Okay, so that's why I have taken the gear ratio here as u. So omega 1 dot by omega 2 dot into omega 1 by omega 1 by omega 2 gives u square into j1. Okay, so this is how we'll be representing the total inertia on the one side, on the wheel side. Okay, and the other thing is like converting this equivalent inertia to the mass. So we know that inertia unit is a kg per meter square. Okay, so if you, this is for like a unit area of the material, unit area. So if you want to convert instead of unit areas, so if you just multiply it with the area, then we'll get like a mass kgs. So now we are converting equivalent inertia to the mass. Okay, so that's what I have done here. And if you look at over here, the same equation, I replaced this part, I have replaced with mj into x double dot. Okay, So to final, it comes like M plus MJ into X double dot equal to F tractive minus resistive forces. Yeah. So this is M plus MJ into X double dot is F net and F tractive, and these are all like F resistive. So the final equation will come something like this. F net equal to F tractive minus F resistive. Okay. So because of this, we can make three conclusions out of this. One is like, if F net equal to zero, it means that the amount of positive power or traction power produced by the engine or power producing unit is equal to the amount of negative force acting on the vehicle, then F net will be zero. So in that case, the vehicle will be in the stationary condition. We can't move the vehicle forward. Okay. Or if F net is greater than zero, it means that the amount of force generated by the power producing unit is greater than the resistive force acting on the vehicle, then the vehicle will be in the acceleration case. Or if it is less than zero, then it will be in the deacceleration case, which means that the resistive force are opposing the, are overcoming the tractive forces. Okay. So in that case, the vehicle will be in the deacceleration mode. Because of this only, the coast down test applies this only. So this is the coast phase where we are opposing the resistive force and moving forward. And this is the down phase where the resistive force are opposing the vehicle and they're overcoming the traction forces. Okay. So these are the two cases. So with this, I hope like, you understand all the forces acting on the vehicle and how to calculate the forces and all the things, right? So now we'll start with the hand calculation part. Okay, we'll try to calculate each and every force for Ather 450. Okay, if you see over here, I just mentioned the specifications of the Ather. Ather is having like a curb mass of the vehicle as 111 kg and driver mass is 80 kg. Gravity value, it is 9.81 meter per second square. Sorry for that. And gear ratio is 7.8. Efficiency of our transmission is 0.85. Top speed it can go is like 80 kmph. Acceleration performance is 0 to 40 kmph in 3.9 seconds. Okay. And the wheel size is like 12 inch in the front and rear. And the drag coefficient, coefficient of rolling resistance and frontal area for this particular vehicle is like 0.22, 0.015, 0.875. So now we know all the parameters that are needed for calculating the resistive forces acting on the vehicle. Okay, so I'll just show you the calculation part, how to do. So you can do along with me so that you'll understand, or if you have any doubt, you can put it on the chat box. Okay. So first I want to tell you that we are calculating this for a particular point of time, because drive cycle is nothing but a velocity variation with respect to time. Okay. So now we are not going to do for the whole drive cycle. So let's say like you are traveling from point A to point B. Okay. So your velocity variation is something like this. So now I'm taking some point somewhere like this, and I'm doing calculation at that particular point of time. What will be your wheel RPM, or what will be the wheel torque? How much amount of forces were acting at that particular point of time? And if you want to overcome the forces acting on the vehicle at that point of time, how much of energy has to be delivered by the battery to the motor, and how much of power has to be delivered by the motor to overcome these forces? Okay, so that's the main agenda of this. So now, as they in the specification sheet, they have mentioned that. In the Ather specification sheet, they have mentioned it as acceleration as 0 to 40 kmph. So this is the time axis. And this is the velocity axis. So the time taken by the vehicle to reach 40 kmph is 3.9 seconds. Okay. So for simplification of the calculation, I'm just increasing 1 second and making it as 4 seconds. Okay, which means that the time taken by the vehicle to reach 40 kmph is 4 seconds. So I'm equally distributing this acceleration. For 1 second of time, it is taking, it is reaching like 10 kmph. In the second, it is reaching 20 kmph. And in the third second, it is reaching 30 kmph. Fourth second, 40 kmph. By the end of 4 seconds, we are at 40 kmph. Okay, which means that at 3.9 second, we are at 39 kmph, and 4 seconds, we are at 40 kmph. Why I'm dividing like this is we have to calculate the acceleration of the vehicle. Okay, so acceleration of the vehicle will be varying with respect to time. Initially, we'll be having high accelerations, but as speed increases, your acceleration will be decreasing, right? So that's the reason, in order to calculate the acceleration at that particular point of time, I have divided the acceleration profile like this. Okay, so this, now what we are going to do is like, we are going to calculate the amount of forces acting on the vehicle at this point of time, which is at t equal to 4 seconds and velocity equal to 40 kmph. So at this point of time, we are going to calculate the rolling distance, the grade resistance, aerodynamic force, and acceleration force, and all these things. And from that, we'll try to bring out the other calculations such as battery pack size and all these things. So first, our main calculation start with rolling resistance. Okay. Because I'll just show you one thing over here. The final outputs we are expecting is inputs. So whenever you're doing some calculation for your, if you want to start building a bike or something car, you have to start with some pre-work that is called as hand calculations. So for that, if you want to understand, like, first you have to start with inputs. What are the inputs I am having? So here I am having like a mass of the vehicle and driver mass is 80 kg. Gravity is 9.81. And the inputs needed for rolling resistance, CRR value, they have given it as 0.015. Okay. So now, as we know that rolling resistance is calculated as gross vehicle weight into quotient of rolling resistance into cos theta. Okay. So let's, for time being, this theta is zero. So this rolling resistance will become gross vehicle weight into quotient of rolling resistance. Okay. So what exactly mean by gross vehicle weight? So when we are telling it as a weight, it is nothing but force. Weight is nothing but a force, which is mass into acceleration due to gravity. So this is mass into acceleration due to gravity, meter per second square, and this is kg. So this finally will give you the Newton. Okay, and CRR is a dimensionless unit, because if you remember when I'm explaining the derivation for CRR, Fz into E equal to Fr into Rr. So Fr equal to Fz into E by Rr. And I replaced it E by Rr as CRR. Okay. So E will be having distance of, unit of distance, that is meters. And Rr will be having the same unit, which is nothing but meter. So meter will get cancelled and CRR will be a constant. So that's why it is called as a dimensionless unit. Okay, so now we are having CRR of 0.015, and we know the mass of the vehicle plus driver mass, and we also know the acceleration due to gravity. So now it's good to go with the calculation of rolling resistance value. So now, rolling resistance equal to gross vehicle weight into CRR. So 111 plus 80 into 9.81 into 0.015. Okay. So 111 plus 80 gives you like a 191 into 9.81 to 0.015. Which gives you like 28.105 newtons. Okay, so this is the F roll, rolling resistance. Okay, so it is always the rolling resistance will be having the unit of newtons, or all the forces will be having the same unit of newtons. Okay, so this is how we'll be calculating the rolling resistance force. As we know that up to a particular period of velocity, this will be a constant value. So this value will be the constant for, let's say, like up to 80 kmph or 90 kmph. After that, it will vary with respect to velocity. So this first calculation, that is a rolling resistance calculation. Next one is a grade resistance calculation. So grade resistance is calculated using the formula. Gross vehicle weight into sine theta. So again, mass into acceleration due to gravity into sine theta. So here, as the vehicle is going in the flat road, theta will be zero. Theta equal to zero for flat road. So hence it will be sine zero is zero. So the total force, mass into G into zero. So finally it will become zero newtons. So this is the F grade, which is nothing but grade resistance. Okay, so this, the amount of force because of the gradability is zero newtons. The third force, aerodynamic force calculation. So aerodynamic force F aero equal to half rho CD A V square. Rho represents the air density, CD represents the drag coefficient, A represents the frontal area, V represents the velocity of the vehicle. Okay, so we know that we are calculating at a particular point of time, where at that point of time the velocity is 40 kmph. But do remember that we must be very careful with the dimensions. Okay, so CD, it is a dimensionless quantity. A is frontal area. So area is nothing but product of length into width. So length is in terms of meters and width is also in terms of meters. So area will become meter square and velocity. Okay, so now this one F aero will be having the unit of newtons because it is the force. Okay, rho is nothing but density. Density is nothing but mass per unit volume. So it will be having the unit of kg per meter cube. So there is no unit for CD. And A is a meter square and velocity. So what can be the velocity unit over here? So in order to get the Newton, Newton is nothing but mass into acceleration. It is nothing but kg meter per second square. So if you want to get this as the output, we have to multiply this with meter square per second square. Okay, then only we'll be getting this unit, because if you multiply this with kmph, which is nothing but kilometers per hour square, then we won't be getting this. So now meter square will be canceled. 1 meter will get canceled with this. So finally, you'll be having kg meter per second square, which is telling that whenever we are taking velocity, it is to be taken as meter per second, not as kmph. Okay. So now the velocity we are having is V equal to 40 kmph. You have to convert this 40 kmph to meter per second. So 1 kmph equal to 5 by 18 meter per second. So 40 kmph, how much? It is 40 into 5 by 18. It is 11.11 meter per second. This is the velocity of the vehicle. Okay, so now everything has been converted to the units which are needed to get the output as newtons. Okay, so now we are going to calculate the F aero. F aero equal to half into density of air is 1.225. So it is at the standard temperature, standard pressure and temperature conditions, which means that 1 atmospheric pressure and 25 degrees Celsius temperature. So 1.225 into CD value is 0.22. Frontal area is 0.875 into 11.11 whole square. So this will come around 14.55 newtons. Okay, so this is the value of aerodynamic resistance. Next, I'll move with the calculation of the acceleration force. So acceleration force F acceleration equal to mass into acceleration. It's not acceleration due to gravity, it is acceleration value, because acceleration due to gravity will be a constant value, whereas acceleration of the vehicle will be changing with respect to time. Okay, that's why I'm mentioning it again. It is not acceleration due to gravity, it is vehicle acceleration, which is varying with respect to velocity or time. So here mass of the vehicle is nothing but curb mass of the vehicle plus driver mass. So it is 191 into acceleration. So what is the acceleration value over here? So previously in the rolling resistance calculation, I told you like what is the acceleration of the vehicle. It is varying something like this. So at this particular point of time, we are calculating, which is, we have taken it as 4 seconds, and this is a 40 kmph. At 3.9 second, it is at 39 kmph. And at the rate of 4 seconds, it is at 40 kmph. Okay, we know that acceleration equal to change in velocity by change in time, which is nothing but dv by dt. So here, again, we have to look into the dimensional units. So acceleration is having unit of meter per second square, but velocity is in terms of kmph. So if you want to convert into meter per second, then if you want to get the unit as a meter per second square, then we have to convert this velocity to meter per second. Then only meter per second divided by second will give you meter per second square. Okay, so this is the dimensional unit we have to follow. So now converting this, it's very simple. dv is nothing but change in velocity. So it is acceleration equal to 40 minus 39 into 5 by 18 divided by 4 minus 3.9. Okay, so it will give you 5 by 18 divided by 4 minus 3.9. So it is giving approximately 2 meters per second square. Okay, so this is the, actually this will be your initial acceleration. What I can tell you is like initially you are starting with a high acceleration of 2.7, but as time goes on, your initial acceleration will get decreased, and it will end up with something like a very less value. Okay, so here we are multiplying it with 191 into 0.27 meter per second square. So it is coming around. Newtons. Okay, so this is the acceleration force acting on the vehicle. So if you know all the forces which are acting on the vehicle, then we can calculate the total resistive force. So total resistive force F resistive or F total equal to F roll plus F grade plus F aero plus F acceleration. So F roll, we got value as 28.105 plus F grade as 0 plus F aero, we got F aero value is 14.55 and F acceleration value is, sorry, 28.105 plus 14.55 plus 0 plus it is 51.57. Okay, so this is the total force. So if you add all these things, we are getting somewhere around like 94.225 newtons. Okay, so this is the total amount of force, F total, which we are getting. Negative force, which is acting on the vehicle. So because of this resistive force, there will be some torque, which the vehicle has to overcome on the wheel side, and there has to be some RPM. Okay, so how to calculate the RPM and how to calculate the torque values. Okay, so first we'll calculate with the wheel RPM. We know that velocity equal to R into omega. So again, here the dimensional units has to be tallied. V is in meter per second. So R is radius, which will be in meters. Omega is radians per second. Okay. So radians is not having the dimensional unit. So when you multiply with some unit, it will change to that particular unit. So meter into radian is converted to meter. So that's why it is meter per second. Okay. So, but what we know here, we know the velocity, that is 40 kmph. And we know the radius of the wheel. Radius is 12 inches. Okay. So it is in inches. So we have to convert this to meters. So conversion of inches to meters, 1 inch equal to 0.0254 meters. Okay, so now 12 inches. It is 12 into 0.0254, which comes 0.3048 meters. Okay, so now we know the radius and we know the velocity, so we can calculate omega, which is radians per second. So now omega equal to V by R, so 40 into 5 by 18 divided by 0.3048. So omega is 11.11 divided by 0.3048. 11.11 divided by 0.3048. It is 36.45 radians per second. But we need wheel RPM. Okay, we don't need like radians per second. We need a wheel RPM. So now wheel RPM is nothing but N wheel. Okay, so we know that omega equal to 2 pi n by 60. It is in radians per second and this is in RPM n. So now if you want to calculate n equal to 60 omega divided by 2 pi.
I think the acceleration is 2.7 then 0.27. I think there was a correction bit before.
Sorry?
The acceleration value is 0.27 or 2.7?
Oh, yeah, the acceleration value. Okay.
Yeah, so I think those considerations have to be put into place, yes.
Yes, give me a second. So yeah, at this point of time, what I want to bring out the point over here is like initial acceleration. What is initial acceleration means? When we are starting the vehicle, what will be the acceleration of the vehicle? So it is nothing but dv by dt. Okay. So we have to reach, we know that A equal to V minus U by T, right? So here final velocity is 40 kmph and initial velocity is 0 kmph. So 40 into 5 by 18 is 11.11. And time taken to reach this is like 4 seconds. Okay. So 11.11 divided by 4 is like 2.78 meter per second square. So that is the initial acceleration needed. But as velocity goes on, this acceleration component will be decreasing. Right? So as velocity increases, the acceleration has to decrease. Okay. So actually we have to consider the acceleration at this particular point of time, not for the whole acceleration period. Okay. So that's why I have taken it as like, it won't be exactly 0.27. We don't add that particular point of time. It depends upon what is the velocity we are getting and all these things. So I've just divided with all the equal components, right? Like 10. For each and every component. That's why I've taken it as like 0.27. I hope you got the point right.
I'm just waiting for the responses in the YouTube because there will be a small delay with the Zoom on the YouTube. So,
okay, cool. So here we'll be having some acceleration value, which is very less compared with this value.
Could you please
be the 0.27. What I'm telling is it will be decreasing, but we don't know the velocity values at that particular interval of time. Okay. So I'm just dividing to equal components. Okay. I'm looking some things over here. Okay. Give me some time we'll take two cases. One is at 2.7. And at the rate of, we don't know the, let's not only 0.27, let's say some acceleration of 1 meter per second or something, we are achieving at this point of time. let's assume the two values. I'll show you like a difference. What happens if you take like a initial acceleration as same as at a time t equal to 4 seconds, or if you decrease the acceleration value to 1 second, what will happen? Okay. I will clear the doubt. So here we are considering the two cases for your clarification, for your doubts. First case, if we take the initial acceleration as same at the point of fourth second also, how much of energy is consuming? And the second case is, in our real case scenario, as the vehicle velocity increases, the acceleration decreases. As we don't know the particular velocity or acceleration at that particular point of time, I'm taking as an assumption of 1 meter per second, not only, not 0.27 also, just take like 1 meter per second square. Then we'll understand like what will be the cases, two cases. Okay, I think now it will be very clear for everyone. Suresh, are you getting any responses for that?
Yes, I know there are a few, it's clear. I think, yeah, if you have clarifications that need to be done. I think considering it 0.27 for the current calculations would pursue with like 2.7 would pursue with the solution, and then at the end of it, maybe we can take another case and clarify it.
Yes, I'll do both the cases.
Yeah, I think we can start with 2.7. I think everybody has the 2.7 maybe in their parts itself, the calculations, so we can stick with that, and then we can redo the 0.27 again. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, sure. So yeah, now if you take it as 2.7, then it will be like 515.7 into 10, it's just so 515.7. Plus 14.55 plus 28.105 will give you like 558.355 newtons. Okay, so that is the total resistive force. And yeah, that's the only small variation. And at the same time, if it is like not 0.27, if it is 1 meter per second square, then it will be 191 into 1. It is nothing but 191 newtons. So the second case, this is first case. F total in the second case is 28.105 plus 14.55 plus 0 plus 191 newtons. So now it will become 105 plus 14.55 plus 191 plus 5 plus 28.105. It is 233.655 newtons. Okay, this is the second case. So we'll understand the difference between these two. Okay, so now there won't be any change in this RPM calculation. It will be the same. So now wheel RPM N equal to 60 into omega. That is nothing but we calculated as a 36.45. 2 into 3.14. 60 into 36.45 divided by 2. Divided by 3.14. It is 348.25 RPM. Please do let me know like if any calculations were going wrong. So yeah, this is the RPM at the particular speed of 40 kmph. So now we'll try to calculate the torque. So wheel torque. So torque will be having the units of Newton meter. So it's nothing but force into perpendicular distance. Okay. So let's take this is the wheel. And whatever the force is acting, it will be converted to over here. And so this is the torque. This is the radius. Now the torque is nothing but this force acting at the wheel into perpendicular distance. The force acting over here is nothing but the total resistive force. Okay. So this is nothing but total resistive force F total into radius of the wheel or wheel radius. So T1, because as we are considering the two cases, so that case one is T1. The values for T1 is 558.355. Into radius of the wheel is 12 inches. That is nothing but 0.3048 meters. Okay, this is in newtons and this is in meters. So units for tally. So it will comes around 558.355 into 0.3048. It is 170.186 Newton meter. Okay. The T2, which is at F2 to F total is different for 1 meter per second square, right? So it is what is the value? 233.655. Into 0.3048. So now this will become 233.655 into 0.3048, which is nothing but 71.218 Newton meter. Okay, so that is the torque available if the acceleration is 1 meter per second square. So these are the two torque values, and the wheel RPM we got around 348.25 RPM. Okay. So these are the wheel torque values and these are the wheel RPM values. Okay. So now what we have done is, first we have calculated what are the amount of forces that are acting on the vehicle at that particular point of time, which is at time t equal to 4 seconds, and velocity is 40 kmph. So for that we have calculated like rolling distance, grade resistance, aerodynamic force and acceleration force, and we added all those things. And after adding all those things, we got the total resistive force. So by using the total resistive force, we calculate the torque, wheel torque, that is 170.186 Newton meter. And we also calculate the wheel RPM by using the V equal to R omega. Okay. So now at the wheel side, we have found all the values. Now what we are going to do is, we are going to convert this wheel side calculations towards the motor side calculations. Okay. So when we are converting these values, there comes the transmission. Okay. So yeah, if you look at over here, so this is at the wheel. So now we calculate the N wheel and T wheel, where N represents the RPM of the wheel and T represents the torque of the wheel. Okay. So if you are coming from this side to this side calculation, it will be something different. And but we are going from wheel to well. Okay. So before that, I just want to clarify that there will be two types of calculations. One is a wheel to well analysis and well to wheel analysis. But the calculations which we are doing now is wheel to well analysis, which are called as a consumption or a sizing analysis. Whereas if you are speaking from well to wheel, they are called as performance analysis, whether we are reaching the drive cycle requirements or not. That comes under performance. Whereas in this, we will talk about like how much of energy is required to reach that particular point of velocity and all these things. Okay. So here we know the wheel RPM and torque at the wheel. Now we want to calculate the motor RPM and motor torque. Okay. So for that, we are using this transmission. So if you see over here, this is the motor that Ather is using, and this is the transmission belt drive, and this is the wheel. Okay. Okay. They have given the transmission differential ratio of 7.8. Okay. So we always have to remember that the RPM of the motor will be always greater than N motor will always greater than N wheel. And next thing is T motor will always less than T wheel because they are inversely proportional. Okay. So now from this, I have written over here, omega motor by omega wheel equal to N, which means that if you want to get the motor RPM, you have to multiply it with wheel RPM and gear ratio. So here N stands for the gear ratio. And similarly, if you want to get the motor torque, we have to divide it with wheel torque. That's why it came reverse. T wheel by T motor equal to N or T motor by T wheel equal to 1 by N. Okay. So don't get confused with this RPM, sorry, gear ratio values. It will be changing according to your calculations. If you are coming from motor to wheel, it will be different. And from wheel to motor, it will be different. Okay. So if you're using something like a multi-stage gearbox, then we have to use like a NI, NF. Okay. Where NI stands for like that particular gearbox. So here we are having only one gear ratio, that is a 7.8. So we are going with these values. Okay. So this is about the transmission. And now I'll show you the calculation of a motor RPM and motor torque. Sorry for this. Sometimes it is losing sense to. Yeah. So now we have calculated the motor torque and motor RPM, sorry, wheel torque and wheel RPMs, right? Now we're using this particular gear ratio and transmission efficiency. We'll calculate the motor torque and motor RPM. So first I'll write it over here, N motor by N wheel equal to gear ratio, that is N. So N motor equal to N into N wheel. So here N value is 7.8 into 348, approximately we got 348.25 something value as 348.25. So now into 7.8, it is 2716.34 RPM on motor side. Okay. So now to calculate the torque, T motor divided by T wheel equal to 1 by N. Okay. So now T motor equal to T wheel divided by N, which is the gear ratio. So here we are having two cases. One is for 2.7 meter per second square, and another one is for like 1 meter per second square. Okay, so now T motor at the rate 2.7 equal to one is 170 and another one is 71. Okay. 170 and 71. 170 divided by 7.8 and T motor at the rate of one is 71 divided by 7.8. Okay. So now at 2.7 it is coming 170 divided by 7.8, it is 21.7 Newton meter, and 71 divided by 7.8, which is 9.1. Okay, so these are the two values. So N motor is 2716 and T motor and there are 2.7 equal to 21.7 and T motor at the rate 1 equal to 9.1 Newton meter. Okay. So these are the torque values we got. Motor RPM we got, motor torque we got. Next thing is like how to calculate the motor power. Okay. So here it comes the motor. So now we are at this particular point. From we started at the wheel side and we reached like towards the motor. So from motor, how much of power has to be delivered so that we'll reach both this motor RPM and torque. Okay. So this is the motor which Ather is using. So they are using like BLDC, brushless DC motor. So if you look at over here, it offers an optimum of 25.0 Newton meter of instant torque and a peak power output of like 5.4 kilowatt. Okay, so that is the peak power and peak torque. And yeah, if you look at over here, I have mentioned one equation. This is the simplified equation to design the motor, where U represents the voltage, L represents the inductance, di by dt represents the change in current, ir represents the voltage, kmf into omega is the omega is the output, and kmf is like back emf constant. Okay, so if you want to simulate the like very basic motor model, we can use that particular equation. And here I want to bring out that torque of the motor will always be proportional to the current, and voltage of the motor will be always proportional to the rpm of the motor. Okay, so that's why if you look at over here, T motor is proportional to current, and so this proportionality replaced with the Km, where Km is called as a torque constant. It will be different for different motors and different motor capacities also. And T motor can also be represented as I told you before, inertia into angular acceleration of the motor. So that is one relation. And as I told you, it is voltage represents omega. So V motor is proportional to voltage of the motor proportional to omega. So this proportionality constant can be replaced with V motor equal to KMF into omega, where KMF stands for back EMF constant. Okay, so it is also varies with the different KMF values. So I forgot to add over here the efficiency point for this torque calculation, because there won't be any losses in the RPM. There will be losses only in the efficiency. So as we are coming from the wheel side to the motor side, we have to divide the efficiency so that all the losses will be considered. So now P motor after losses. Okay, so this is nothing but T motor at the rate 2.7 equal to 21.7 divided by 0.85 will give you 25.5 Newton meter, and T motor at the rate 1 gives you like 9.1 divided by 0.85. It is 10.7. Okay, so those are after considering the losses. But when we are coming from motor to wheel, then we have to multiply this efficiency. Okay, so that you have to keep in mind. We are going from wheel to well now. So yeah, so this is how we'll be getting the voltage of the motor and the current of the motor. So now we'll try to calculate the motor power calculation. So there are two things. One is the mechanical power, which is nothing but 2 pi and T by 60. Okay, so here we know the RPM of the motor and torque of the motor. So it is nothing but 2716.34. 2 into 3.14 into 2716.34 into 25.5 and 10.7. Okay. So 25.5 divided by 60. So this gives P1, that is 2 into 3.14 into 2716.34 into 25.5 divided by 60, which is 7249.9 watts. Okay, it is nothing but 7.249 kilowatt. P2, the same, but the torque variation is there, right? So into 2716.34 into 10.7 divided by 60. So now it is coming 3042.11 watts. That is nothing but 3.042 kilowatt. Okay, so these are the power values, power required at that particular point of time. Okay, so with this we are done with the motor power calculations, and we have to calculate the motor current. Okay, so yeah, I'll calculate those things over here. First, before going to the battery pack, I'll calculate the motor current first of all. So motor current is nothing but we are having power equal to voltage into current, right? So here we are having two power, mechanical power. So that will be the same. So motor current equal to power by voltage. So let's say we are taking 48 volt. Okay. So now one is 7.249 kilowatt. Divided by 48. Gives like 151 amps approximately with 48 volt. And similarly, and motor current for second case, it's 3.042 approximately divided by 48. equal to approximately 63.3 amps. Okay, so these are the motor currents, and we know the motor power, it is 7.249 and 3.042. Okay, so after this motor will be having like the motor will be connected to the converters. So this converter will be connected to the battery pack. So this is the motor. These are the converter, DC to AC or AC to DC. Okay, so let's assume that the efficiency of these things were like 95% efficiency. Okay, so then we can get the motor battery pack power, and battery pack voltage will be the same, like 48 volt battery pack will be using. So we can calculate the battery current. So if you look at over here, this is a very basic equation. So power ideal equal to V open circuit voltage into current, V terminal equal to V open circuit minus IR. Okay, so let's say this is the battery and there is a resistor connected in series. So this will be our V terminal and this will be an open circuit voltage and this is the R. So there will be a voltage drop across this resistor. That is nothing but V terminal into V terminal equal to V open circuit minus IR. So this is the ideal case, means assuming that there are no losses, but in real case scenario, there will be losses like heat generation losses or I square R losses or bus bar losses. There will be many losses. Okay, but we are considering the simple case. So assuming 95%, so first thing is like battery power calculation. Battery power equal to motor power divided by efficiency of converters. Okay, so motor power is 7.249 for the first case, 8.95, and second case it is 3.042 divided by 0.95. So this will give you like 7.249 divided by 0.95. which is 7.63 kilowatt, and 3.042 divided by 0.95, which will give you like 3.2 kilowatt. Okay, case one at the rate of 2.7 and at the rate of 1 battery power this. Okay. So if you know the battery powers, we can calculate the battery currents. I battery is nothing but 7.63 kilowatt voltage divided by, sorry, power divided by voltage. It is 48. So it is 7.63 divided by 48, which gives like 158 or 159 amps. And this case one, 2.7 I battery at the rate of 1 is 3.2 divided by 48, which is like 66.6 amps. Okay, so now we calculate the battery currents also. We know the battery pack voltage, so that we'll get the battery pack power. Okay, so now we are left out with like number of cells connected in series, number of cells connected in parallel, and total number of cells. So that I'll do that also. So here, number of cells connected in series, N series equal to pack voltage, which is nothing but battery pack voltage divided by cell voltage. Okay. So here, let's assume that we are using a 3.6 nominal cell voltage. Okay, so pack voltage is 48 and cell voltage is 3.6. So it will give you number of cells connected in series. So 48 divided by 3.6 is 13.3 cells in series. Okay, similarly, N parallel equal to pack capacity divided by cell capacity. Okay, so what exactly pack capacity represents? So pack capacity represents energy. Capacity is nothing but amp hours. So, but we are getting only amps here. Okay. So let's assume that I think you understand the difference between the amp hour and amp. So amp hour means the amount of current that can be withdrawn from a cell for 1 hour of time. Okay. Let's say like if you say 2.6 amp hour, it means that 2.6 amps of current can be withdrawn from the cell for 1 hour of time. Okay. So based upon the currents, let's assume that we need a capacity like 6 amp hour. So how I'm telling the 6 amp hour is we have to do the simulations. Then only we'll get like this capacity. First of all, we'll get the energy. So because now we are doing it for a particular point of time. So at that particular point of time, we can't tell like how much of energy it is. We can speak only in terms of power. Okay. So energy is integration of power with respect to time. Okay. Now we can't say in terms of energy, right? So that is one of the backdrop of this hand calculation, where we'll be overcoming that in the simulations. So in simulations, what we can do is like over a period of time, we can integrate the power and we'll get the total battery pack energy. Okay. So here, let's say like, we are using 6 amp hour cell. Okay. So, and sorry, 6 amp hour battery pack capacity, total capacity of the battery pack is 6 amp hour pack capacity. And cell capacity is like 2 amp hour. Okay. So in that case, it will be 6 amp hour divided by 2 will give you like 3 cells. Okay. So again, I'm telling you, you might get confused with this value which I'm taking. Here, as we are doing it for a particular point of time, we can calculate only the power, because energy is integration of power with respect to time. Okay, so we don't have the data of future values and the previous values. So that's the reason we can't go with those integration values. And for that purpose, let you understand like how to calculate the number of cells in parallel. I'm assuming that pack capacity is 6 amp hour and the cell capacity is 2 amp hour, which will give you the number of cells in parallel. Okay, so now n total gives you like a number of cells n series into n parallel. So 13.3 into 3, which is nothing but let's say like 13.3, we assume 14 cells in series and 13 cells in parallel. 14 into 3 gives like a 42 cells, total number of cells. So this is the n total. Total number of cells required is like 42 cells. Okay. So with this, we have completed the battery pack calculations also. Okay. So now I want to bring the comparisons. Okay, now you asked, right, like what will happen, why you are going with the 2.27 or 1 meter per second square instead of 2.7 meter per second square. Okay, so I want to tell you that that is also one of the disadvantages of this hand calculation part, which you can be overcome in simulation part, but I will show you the variations. Okay. For that, I want to show you like specifications of the, yeah. I think they are mentioned somewhere over here. Suraj?
I don't know.
Can you tell me like what is the peak torque of Ather motor? I think it is missing over here.
20.5 newton meter.
Yeah, it is 20.5 meters newton meter, right?
Yep, that's right.
Yes. Okay. I will remove this calculation over here. Yes. So yeah, peak torque of the motor is 20.5 newton meter. this is from the Ather specification sheet. We are not telling any value. And can you tell me like peak power? Suraj?
Peak power is around 5.4 kilowatt.
Yeah, 5.4 kilowatt. Okay. So peak torque, which means that this is the maximum torque that can be drawn from the motor side. Okay. But if you observe here at 40 kmph, we are withdrawing 25.5 Newton meter, which means that we are overcoming the peak torque itself. Why we are overcoming that peak torque is because of assuming the acceleration as same as initial acceleration. Okay. So initial acceleration is 2.7. And at 4 seconds also, we are going with the same acceleration, which means that at 40 kmph, we are requiring like, 20.5 Newton meter means like we are going with a high velocity as well as gradability. Okay, which can't be possible. So that's the one reason I told you like the acceleration of the vehicle will be decreasing as velocity increases. So we have to take some less value compared with the initial acceleration. If you take other combustion vehicles also, initially we'll be having like high accelerations, but as velocity increases, your torque requirement will be decreasing, right? Because RPM and torque are inversely proportional. If you look at the power curves, yeah, before going to the power curves, I will just show you the example of power also. If you look at over here, the peak power itself is 5.4 kilowatt that can be drawn from the motor side. But now we are getting, if you take off 2.7, what is the power we are getting? 7.24 kilowatt, which is not at all possible. Okay, if you are going with that acceleration, with that velocity, it means that we are assuming acceleration is wrong concept. Okay, so in order to make sure that comparison, we have taken the less value of acceleration there. So it might give you like second case, I have taken one acceleration, right? 1 meter per second square. If you observe, the power requirement is 3.042 kilowatts, which means that it is less than the peak power requirement. Okay. So that's why we have to take the exact acceleration value at that particular point of time. Okay. So that as we don't know the future and previous velocity values. Okay. So because of that, we are assuming some acceleration value, but if you know like future and previous velocity values, then we can predict the acceleration at that particular point of time, and we can calculate the power and all these things, torque, so that we'll get like exact values which satisfies the motor also. Okay, so that is one of the disadvantages. That is the only reason I have taken the different value of acceleration. By now you might get like what is the variation of acceleration? If yes, please do post in the chat box so that I'll move on to the next concept. Okay.
As always, like there's a small delay with Zoom and also the YouTube.
Okay.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah, if there's a possibility, maybe we can have this one on the screen to see the questions. Yeah, I think there are a couple of answers. Yeah, it's a yes. A couple of yes are there here.
Okay.
Yeah, I think we should be good to go. Yes.
Yes. Okay. So yeah, that's the only drawback of this hard calculation. And another drawback is like, we can't calculate all these things for each and every second. Okay. So that can be overcome by using the, what we call simulation models. And here we are getting like 7.249 kilowatt power. Okay. And here we're getting 3.042 kilowatt. Our peak power itself is like 5 kilowatts. So these are the small variations. If you're withdrawing like 3.042 at 50 kmph, then at higher velocities, what is the power we can draw? So it depends on all those things. And if you look at like motor side, where is the motor torque? Yeah, I think I already explained this, 25.5 and 10.7. So we are getting 25.5 at the RPM of 2716. If you have the, actually we didn't get the data sheet of the motor, which Ather is using. if you're having the like data sheet of the motor, it will be something like this. So it is for your better clarification, I'm giving these details. So it will be something like this. Here we'll be having the RPM axis. Here we'll be having like torque axis. So here we'll be having the efficiency points. Okay, so it will be something like this. So this represents about 20.5 Newton meter of torque. And it represents your base speed. Okay. And this represents your power curve, max power curve. And this is your, this max power curve, this max torque. And this is your max RPM region. Okay. So when we are going at this, I mean, most of the cases, acceleration will take place in the max torque region because we need like more torque to reach the high velocities. So in that particular region only, we'll be like requiring more torque. So let's say like we are going like this, okay? At 20.5, we require like this much of torque to get the 40 kmph. But the base speed will be somewhere around like 1000 RPM or 1200 RPM. Okay, but for this 40 kmph, what is the RPM we are getting? We are getting somewhere around like 2700, which means the double the base speed RPM. Sorry. So, yeah, double the base speed RPM. It will be somewhere around here, which means that, see here, let's say this is 2700 RPM. Okay, so at this 2700 RPM, the torque availability will be somewhere around, let's say 10.15 or 10 Newton meter. We can't go for this particular point of 20.5 Newton meter. Okay. So that's the reason which is telling that the acceleration of the vehicle will be decreasing for sure. So that's the one, that's the another explanation also for your doubt. Okay. So yeah, I hope you got clear idea on this calculation part. And I think some people might get confused with this cell capacity. So I'll give you a clear idea on this also. So in real case scenario, what will happen is your drive cycle will be something like this. Okay. So for that particular drive cycle, you'll be getting acceleration curves, something like this. And you'll be getting the total resistance force curves. And from that, we'll get like a power curves, wheel RPM, torque, and everything curves will be there. Okay, so let's assume this is the power curve. Okay, so if you integrate this particular power curve, we'll get the energy, total amount of energy required. So let's say like after integrating this particular power curve, I'm getting 3 kWh. Okay, so power means 3 kW, energy means with respect to time, power equal to work done by time or energy by time. So energy equal to power into time. So this will give you like 3 kWh per hour or whatever the drive cycle time you are having. So let's take example of NADC drive cycle. It is having drive cycle time of 1180 seconds. So it depends upon the drive cycle time. So from that, you'll get the total energy. So let's say you got like 3 kWh. So if you know the 3 kWh, you know the voltage also. So 3000 watt hour divided by voltage is 48 volt battery pack. Okay. So this represents your cell capacity, battery pack capacity. Sorry. This is pack capacity. Okay. So 3000 divided by 48 will give you like a 62.5 amp hour. Okay, why I'm telling amp hour is watt means voltage into current. So the unit of voltage is volt and current unit of current is amps. So it will become volt amp. Volt will get cancelled. There will be amp and hour. So that's why it becomes amp hour. So this is the total amount of capacity required for the particular drive cycle. Okay, So now we know the pack capacity, and we are using a cell which is having cell voltage of 3.7 volts and cell capacity of 6 ampere. Okay. So this is the cell and this is the per pack. So number of cells that has to be connected in parallel are pack capacity divided by cell capacity, which is nothing but 62.5 divided by 6 ampere will give you like a 10.4 cells or 10 cells in series parallel. Okay. So in the previous calculation also, as it is not possible to integrate the power values because we are having only at particular point of time, we assume some pack capacity values and I have derived like number of cells connected in parallel. Okay. That is one of the drawback of the hand calculations, which will be overcome by the simulations. Okay. I hope you understand this.
Right, Venu. I think.
Here.
Go ahead.
Yeah. So for your clarification, I just kept one graph, which tells you like, which gives you a clear idea on like what is the pros and cons of hand calculation versus the simulation. So if you look at over here, the first plot shows the drive cycle, which is the time versus speed. After that, by using this drive cycle, we have performed some calculations in the simulation by using the same formulas which I taught you now, but we have implemented that in the simulation, which will give you like a motor torque with respect to time. This is the motor torque. If you see here, each and every second, the motor torque is varying. Okay. And if you look at our here, this is giving like a speed, motor torque, and this is the power curve. Okay. So all these operating points were inside this particular power curve only. The points which are out of this power curve can't be achieved with that particular motor. Okay, so we have to make sure that all the operating points were inside this motor curve, power curve. Okay, this is also the same thing, but different profile this is. Okay, so this we'll be doing in the simulation part. I think we'll be showing the simulation part also. So yeah, that's all from my side.
Right, Venu. I think that's really great to run through, you know, the whole details of the course. I believe it was quite interesting for everybody who's participating there. So I would just quickly take a few minutes here to just, you know, showcase the model of the simulation. I'm sorry, due to COVID, number of cases in Bangalore being high, so I have to stick to my house. There's some disturbances in the back end, and apologies for that. So if you're hearing a small noises in the other places. So Venu, can you stop the sharing and give an access to Bharat to share the screen?
Yes.
Yes, please. And Bharat, you could share the screen from your side. Awesome. So that sounds pretty here. All right. So before we start the simulation part of it, I would like to just give some inputs on feedback. Or anything else. To receive the certificate, yeah, you have to visit the lms.decibelslab.com. And if you go there, you need to sign in to the website, lms.decibelslab.com website, and sign in. Then you, when you log in, you will visit the dashboard. If you visit the dashboard, click on the course, and you have to fill the feedback form there itself, and there is no other way. It is not a Google form or any of those, things. It is in the website. So it has to be done there itself in the course for anybody who had clarifications on Mr. Kirti Sagar. So yeah, it is not something that we can share it over there in the YouTube link. So it has to be done over there in the course itself. Yeah. So, all right. So that's a bit on the input about the certificate part. I would be just moving into the Scilab software part two. All right. So here, what you see on the screen is a Scilab model, which we have built. And I would say this is a preliminary model of the Scilab because there are a lot of advanced models also because we have built with our customers to deliver major project with various clients in India and other countries also. So why we perform simulations in the software is basically like, you know, it gives you more flexibility to study the model in detail. For an example, if I tell you you did a calculation with respect to one point, right? Like, but when we are running the vehicle, it is not operating at a one point. It is continuously operating at various different points. Maybe like, you know, you're accelerating your vehicle, you're decelerating your vehicle, you're going at top speeds. The roads are not flat. There is an inclination. Somebody comes in front of you. There's a lot of these realistic conditions, right? So for a lot of these realistic conditions, so you have to, perform a simulation to get real-time results. What I mean as real-time results is like, you know, if we plot the graph of motor efficiency, and that is torque with respect to torque and RPM, the efficiency of the motor is continuously varying, right? In our calculation, we consider it as a one single, like constant efficiency. But in the reality, it won't be like that, correct? And take another example. The efficiency of the motor also get varied with respect to temperature, right? The temperature would be possibly increased because of motor is running and there's a current flowing through the conductor. There's a heat losses and like the IR losses. And there are various different losses. So heat is generated within the motor. Then second thing is, if the atmospheric temperature is higher, then the heat will be also generated over there, right? So when we are doing that, we're not considering any of these things. We're not studying the influence of temperature. We are not studying the influence of motor torque and if RPM with respect to the efficiency and of the motor. There are various parameters like this, right? So this is not considered when you're performing a model, when you're performing a hand calculation. And it is impossible also because motor is like varying at 10,000 different points. And how do you actually calculate? The same way if you go to a battery side, right? Now the battery is also like getting affected. If the temperature of the battery is going high, then the battery discharge characteristics are different. If the temperature of the battery is going down, then the characteristics are different. Like this, there are a lot of parameters which is influencing the battery pack design. And the other side is auxiliary loads. The meaning of auxiliary loads is like when you talk about the loads such as the air conditioning system or the headlights, horns, indicators. Like there are so many different things, right? Like whether there's a charger in your phone, lap bike or something like that. So all of this is consuming energy. So like when we tell a system is a time dependent system, okay? So time dependent dynamic system. So we can't actually do a hand calculation and perform all the simulations, okay? So when the system is time dependent and dynamic system, you have to build a simulation model to study the complete dynamics of the system. So that is why we have to, if you want to pursue further, you know, development in EV, or if you want to build a EV, the fundamental thing is you have to have a simulation model. There is no point that, you know, you can just do hand calculation and take it out. But hand calculation gives you a very solid foundation on how we actually calculate, right? And then further on, you could build a models and advancements and things like that. So Decibels has been one of the biggest consulting firm. We've been helping out various different startups in India to build these models, you know, advance these models. And with that experience, we are also having knowledge to, like having that knowledge, we are also providing a lot of training programs too on the simulation side of it. So here is a simulation model. I believe that gives you kind of a very big overview, at least a very small overview on, you know, why we perform simulations. So coming to the point of the simulation itself, like the whole model looks like this. We would just try to show you one of the model because the time is a limitation as such here. So Bharat, can we go into the chassis model? And you know, the same way we are trying to represent, right? Like we are trying to calculate the vehicle speed. So here we are trying to define the drive cycle. Drive cycle is the input from the Excel file. Like, you know, like you've seen the graph, right? The drive cycle graph. But Reno was showing in the last slides, the graph which was showing like up and downs. So we feed that in the form of Excel file into the software. And from there, Excel file will take the data into the model. So then now that is running with respect to the time, and then our inputs are coming into the model. We are doing the same calculations as a part of that in the model here itself. You see, we did a wheel speed calculation. We are doing a wheel torque calculation. So what was the wheel speed calculation? Because we know the vehicle speed, we know the tire diameter. You can always calculate the wheel speed, correct? But can you run through just wheel speed calculation as simplicity? So if you see the model, which will be demonstrated for you here, so it will contain the part of the wheel speed calculation, right? It's pretty simple. We are inputting the value of drive cycle, like a wheel speed, okay? And then we have radius of the wheel, and there's a constant for conversion. We put that and we get RPM of the wheel, like a wheel RPM, right? The same way you did a calculation, right? For the wheel RPM and the wheel torque. We're trying to do the same thing here. So we can close this part. We can go to the wheel torque section. So yeah, we can move on to the wheel torque section. In the wheel torque section, how do we get a wheel torque? We get a wheel torque because of, it's a summation of all the forces. And then we know the wheel diameter, we will be able to calculate all the things. That's the way we have done all the formulas integrated together into a simulation model. And we are able to, like, you know, multiply that all the forces with the radius of the tire. So then we get the wheel torque, right? So this is a way we are able to calculate all these values. And this is the approach of building the simulation model. I know it is not something that, you know, we can, because it is around 14 hours of course to build this simulation model, which we have extensively for learners out there. So we can close this, Bharat, as a part of it. So yeah, so in the similar way, as you build the model of the wheel torque, wheel speed, you know, we were able to get, Bharat, you can close this, we can go to the main model. We are able to also create the whole model in the same way. Okay, so by building the model in transmission, we built a model of the motor by considering various different parameters, like the same calculation process where it was followed, we have built a model by considering certain data of the powertrain, by considering certain information of the data, like, you know, other values of motor and things like that. So build the whole model. Okay, so when we build the whole model, we can run the simulation. Bharat, do we have the graphs if in case? Yeah. So if you see here that, you know, already we have run the simulation, because simulation takes some while to run it. So that's why we have all the data here. But if you can put the data in the whole, like a metro format, all the data possibly. So most of the graphs. So what we get is, like, you know, where at the point of the hand calculations, you're trying to do it at a one point, right? At a one specific value. But when you run a simulation, you can run a simulation for n number of points and you get a data. And that is, by this data, you're able to calculate, like, actually motor torque, motor RPM, all these things. Okay. So if you see here, motor torque is coming around 7.2 Newton meter. Why? Because in the drive cycle, the acceleration values are not higher. Acceleration numbers are smaller. That's why it is coming around 7.8. So, but if you consider acceleration test, that time in the acceleration test, the wheel torque will be higher. Because, you know, if you have observed very clearly, if you build a model and, you know, if you have observed, like wheel, like major force contributing to the vehicle, resistive forces is acceleration force. If you keep the vehicle to accelerate too fast, then it consumes too much of torque. And the torque is again directly proportional to flux, and flux is directly proportional to current. And the more current is drawn from the battery pack. So this is all in, like, in a relationship, which drives the whole model, right? So when you perform the whole simulation, and we do our various different type of tests, acceleration test, gradability test, drive cycle test, like this, and you know, with all the auxiliary loads test and things like that, then depending upon, we will be able to calculate the complete model of the EV. And when we run the simulation with all that simulation data, we get some mature data to decide the motor size, battery size, conductor selection, fuse selection, pre-charge resistor selection, like a lot of these things. You know, when we do the one step, because we also have experience, with all that experience, we know this would be the right data. Then what we do in the next step is, like, you know, we build the one vehicle or two vehicles. We'll take them to test runs. You know, test runs. When we do a test runs, we get a correlation between our simulation data and the practical data. So then we try to improvise the model. You have seen the first video, right? Venu was playing the first video. There's a company called Apple's Idiada. So, like, you know, they charge like a lot of money to do these tests, because the tests are very accurate and it has to be very precise. And, you know, when you run this when you run these tests, you will be able to exactly calculate at the reality how the forces will be varying, how the contribution of forces will be there in the powertrain, and what will be the losses in the components and things like that. Without all that, it's like a, like, you know, we build a model, we create a vehicle, then we again run the vehicle, we get a data, we improvise a model. It's like a cyclic process. And then we come to a very big, good amount of maturity in the value and correlation between the model and the real-time vehicle. Then we go ahead for the production. That is when the part ordering and everything will come into a picture. This is a typical process every industry takes. Okay, so we build a model, we call it like a model in the loop simulation, Then once the model is done, we do something also called as HIL, hardware in the loop testing, and software in the loop testing before that. This, there's a very, very structured process industry follows. And the same thing, the first ever step is that a simulation, basically. You have to perform simulation like this, build a model, simulations, then understand the deeper component, like sizing, and also like influence of certain parameters and all this stuff. Then you can decide the component sizing. I know it is a very huge amount of work that has to be done. So we have made it very simplified with our courses in LMS website. So if you're interested, in the upcoming next weekend, there is a course available. If you're there, you can contact all the community leads. They also have certain coupon codes that they can share to you that will give you some discounts for all the people who are interested to learn. For students, we have a four-week internship program, internship program on electric vehicle powertrain modeling and simulation. So where you will build the model of the Ather 450, you will build the model of Nissan Leaf, you'll also build the model of Formula Electric race car. Already more than, I think, 800, 900 students have completed that course, and amazing amount of learning they have done through. So if you're interested, you could definitely contact all the community leads. So then they'll be able to help you with the course, and also they can be able to help you with the coupon codes that give you some of the discounts on the courses. Yeah. So there will be a first point of contact for all the courses as such. You could definitely contact them, and on the Decibels Lab website also you have details over there. So as such, you know, going to the detailed model would be very extensive amount of time. We already ran 8 minutes late to complete the session. So as such, what I mean is, like, what you right now learned is the amazing fundamental step, and that's where everybody starts it. Now you have learned that if you want to progress ahead and, you know, build anything towards the industry grade or industry standards, or if you want to get into the industry areas of it, yeah, so you would actually have to develop the models and our model-based approaches, because that's the only way how it has been done into a place. So there are a lot of different softwares. There is a Scilab, there's a Matlab, there is a Ricardo Ignite is there. Then there is a tool called IGP CarMaker. Like, there are various different softwares. So why do we use specific softwares? It is because, you know, Scilab is just very lightweight. It's just like a 250 MB file. Anybody can download very quickly, run it, install it. Like, it is not too heavy. Okay. So students can actually download into the computers very easily without a big hassle and things like that. And there is no licensing cost for that. And that makes your life easier to download a software and, you know, install it and run it and, you know, get more knowledge quickly through that. Yeah. So that's why we are trying to use Scilab software. So that's pretty much about the course content we wanted to cover up. I believe it gave you a very good knowledge and experience, exposure at least to work on EVs, and at least to know, understand a few of the systems of the EVs by this way. So I'm very sure that, you know, what you've learned is a very small amount of knowledge. So I think it is a huge amount of requirement is there on the other side to get into the EV, to build EVs. So I urge everybody, that's the motivation to conduct, you know, we are putting so much of time and efforts, is all because, you know, we want to bring more people into EV sector. All our community leads want to bring more people into community EV sector. So by that way, you upskill more, maybe not with decibels, on your self-learning or anything of that sort. So you always take it ahead and, you know, country needs good engineers. Country needs engineers to bring sustainable mobility. So that is all we and you can do by contributing our time and efforts and energies to build better vehicles into the whole area of sustainable mobility. So I think by pointing that out, so I would bring in some more points. The certifications, as I said, you have to visit lms.decibelslab.com and go to the course. There is a quiz and also the feedback. For sure, you know, we wanted to bring that seriousness in everybody that, you know, when you only learn, you know, certificates are valid, right? Like, or else, like, what is the use of the damn certificate without a knowledge, right? And I think by taking a feedback of 5,000 students and this, so like, there is no point of having a certificate without a knowledge, right? So I think by that way, we have made it mandatory to learn and also take the quiz and answer the questions and then get the certificate, and you feel proud of having the certificate than just certificates. So I think by keeping that as a motivation, and we want to bring in people who really can contribute than people who can really get just certificates. So by that way, we are serious, because what is the point in teaching somebody who's not motivated to participate in EVs, right? It's a lot of time and efforts everybody is trying to put into a place. With that motivation, we kept things very structured. So I kindly, I request you to support for that kind of an ecosystem if you're serious. So visit lms.decibelslab.com, go to the course. Once you go to the course, you will be able to see the details of quiz, feedback form, and then any of the rest of the information. If you complete your course 100%, then the certificate will automatically come. On the below, there are options like, you can see the share in LinkedIn, you get a URL, you can share it there. It is not going to expire anytime, so it's always available with you. Then you can also get this on the other side, that click on the other two buttons, other two empty buttons visible to you. If you click on that, one is to download an image of the certificate, other is to download a PDF of the certificate. Okay, so those things can be done. I think that's pretty much about the whole session as a part of it. There are a few questions which are here. I would appreciate that if I could try answer them. I'll try to answer them once I say thank you, Sanket, and also Walid Ishan. So thank you everybody for taking your time and putting all the efforts to participate, making all the dedication to spend 3 hours taking it up. I believe that just keeps us very much motivated that there are more people to learn like this. And we are always there to teach. And all the courses from Decibels LMS for L1 courses will be available for free. We commit for that. And there will be one course every weekend, which you can spend the same time just spend now and take up all your learning as much as possible. Same courses would cost you like a lot of money if you were to go and buy outside. So, but with detailed content structure, clarity of the content, nothing that we can hide from our side. So we would definitely help you as best as possible. Yeah. So by that way, we would keep it best as possible for all of us. And thank you very much again.
Suraj, one point from my side.
Yeah.
Hey, Suraj, one point from my side.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah. Okay. So I also want to bring out the point that what is the disadvantage of, we did right for two cases, acceleration of higher acceleration, lower acceleration. Mm-hmm. If you observe whatever the current values we are getting for the first case 150 amps, and for the second case, we are getting half of the value, somewhere around 60 amps. Mm-hmm. So there is a huge amount of variation in the currents, right? So mm-hmm. that huge amount of current variations will give you wrong expectations or energy estimation values, which mm-hmm. leads to will make you to take higher battery packs when you're going for the race car teams.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, which is a very bad, parameter. If you're going with the higher values of current,
mm-hmm.
so you have to, of course, you have to take a high battery pack mass, which decrease your performance and all these things. I forgot to mention that point over the discussion.
Okay.
Yeah. That's the one point I want to mention. So it's right. Good to go with simulations and then decide your battery pack values and all these things.
Yeah. Definitely, Venu. Good point to be noted. I think, So that's pretty much from our side, I think, to overall cover it up. Mr. Mohammed and also Mr. Bajinder, it is not something we can share. It is not a Google form that we can share. It is a different link. That is, there is no link for that, by the way, to share it here. And already there are people who have completed the quiz. They're getting the certificates. So it means that it is available for everybody. So we will send an email to you. If so, we're not able to access it, and then how to access it. So that is the only way. There is no other way to actually access the certificates, and there is no other way that we can generate certificates as such anybody else does. So that's pretty much from our side. 100% for sure it will be available, so you could take it up, and if we will send you an email on any of the further steps and stuff like that. So thanks again, everyone. Thanks a lot for your time and dedication to take up, to involve in the whole process and being a great audience. That's pretty much from our side, and thank you a lot. Take care, and good day ahead for all of you, and stay safe, be safe, and happy learning to everybody. Thank you. So I think for a few people who had questions here, so I have a project goal, a programming application to contract pricing of electric vehicle. Please guide me to find the data. We can complete a project. Walid, you can connect to us at you can write an email at contact@decibelslab.com. So we will try to help you. Yeah. So I think apart from it, so sodium batteries, I know for sure it is not something we can discuss here. Maybe we could see through that we can discuss in the next week, because that is of a session about cell and chemistry. We would try to discuss about it there. So that's pretty much from all of our side. So thank you everyone for joining it, joining the session. We'll look forward to see you in the upcoming days, and keep learning, keep exploring, and take care.